Welcome to Airchecks. Archie Andrews was a teenage sitcom directly adapted from the very popular comic strip of Bob Montana. It began to be heard on NBC Blue on May 31, 1943 and lasted on air until September 5, 1943, the period during which radio adaptations of comic characters were trending. The show was also broadcasted on Mutual from 1944 to 1945. Kenneth Banghart served as the announcer, while Bob Hastings played the lead character Archie during the show's NBC times. Other actors that took over the main role include Burt Boyar, Jack Grimes, and Charles Mullen. The other important character role, Jughead, was given to Cameron Andrews and Hal Stone. Up to now, Archie Comics is still popular and loved by many fans. Here is the first episode of Archie Andrews from June 23, 1945 called, Nazi POW in Riverdale.
Hello?
Hello, Jughead, this is Archie. Come over right away. It's a matter of life or death.
Oh, relax, Archie, relax.
Yes, indeed, it's time for Archie Andrews, his family and his friends. Archie, Jug, Mom, Dad, Betty, Veronica, and all the gang in the little town of Riverdale. They're all familiar to millions of readers of Archie Comics magazine, and now they come to radio. So relax, folks, relax. You've heard the old saying, never look a gift horse in the mouth. Well, as far as Archie's concerned, that's a horse of a different color. And furthermore, today's story has nothing to do with horses. It's all about, well, listen and find out. It's early morning, and we find Mr. and Mrs. Andrews in the dining room at breakfast.
Where's the toast, Mary?
Oh, it's right in your hand, Fred.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm all mixed up.
Now, dear, you'll just have to relax.
Yeah, I know, but I haven't got much time this morning. I have to be in the office in 10 minutes and clean up my work and meet the 11 o'clock train.
Oh, goodness, you don't have to swallow your toast in one piece. You'll get indigestion
again. Well, I can't help it, Mary. Mr. Lodge has appointed me a committee of one to meet Mr. Hotchkiss and show him around the school. It's entirely up to me to... Don't we have any butter today?
It's margarine, Fred, and it's right next to your coffee.
Oh, yeah, I can't seem to keep my
mind. Now, dear, you just have to get hold of yourself. The way you act, anybody would think it was a matter of life or death.
Well, don't you think the education of the future generation of Riverdale is important, Mary? And don't you think that my contribution is worth anything?
Now, Fred, I never said
that. I am fully aware of what you said, Mary. As the committee of one, it's up to me and no one else to convince Mr. Hotchkiss that an annex to the high school is absolutely vital.
Yes, Fred, I know. And I'm sure that Mr. Hotchkiss will realize the importance of the annex and will agree to recommend the necessary funds.
That's where you're wrong, Mary. Mr. Hotchkiss is a hard nut to crack. He's a representative of the governor's office, and where funds are concerned, they... Now, what happened to my coffee?
Oh, you got your sleeve in it, Fred.
Oh, darn it. Everything's going wrong today. Well, I gotta go. Goodbye, Mary.
Goodbye, Fred.
Oh, and there's one more thing. Be sure not to use the car today. It's got a carbon monoxide leak, which has to be fixed. Something wrong with the exhaust.
Oh?
I'm gonna call the garage. And don't forget about the dinner, dear. Mr. Hotchkiss is a stickler.
Yes, girl. Fred, I know. You already told me.
Now, you don't have to bite my head off, Mary, just because I'm concerned.
But I'm not biting your head off. It's you who's been up in the air.
Now, Mary, I haven't said anything that you could possibly misinterpret.
I'm not misinterpreting.
Well, you said...
I think, Fred, that you're making a mountain out of a molehill.
Now, Mary, that kind of accusation... will only lead
Fred, I'm losing my patience.
Well, how do you think I feel? Don't you know that...
Morning, everybody.
And that'll be enough out of you, young man.
Gee whiz, what did I do?
I don't know. Nothing. Never mind. Just make sure you don't do it.
Do what, then?
Well, never mind. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Fred.
Golly, what's Dad so sore about this morning?
Oh, he's worried about the future of Riverdale, Archie.
He is? Is it something I should worry about, too, Mom?
No, now you sit down and eat your breakfast.
Yes, Mom.
And don't make a career of it, dear. I have to be in the day nursery in 10 minutes.
Okay, Mom. I'll finish my orange juice and toast and oatmeal and milk and eggs and jam before you can say... Before you can... Well, gee whiz.
What's the matter now, Archie?
Gee, look at this headline.
What headline? Where are you going, Archie?
I'm going to call Jughead. Oh, boy.
Archie, will you please finish your breakfast?
Yeah, Mom, in just a minute. Riverdale 4-7, operator, 4-7.
Riverdale 4-7.
As soon as I'm finished with this call, Mom, I just want to talk to Jug. Boy, is this going to be something.
Hello?
Hello, Jughead, come on over. It's a matter of life or death.
Relax, Archie, relax.
But, Jughead, it's right in this morning's paper. Look for yourself. I mean, listen to this. It says, Nazi prisoner escapes from camp near Riverdale. All citizens are urged to keep a sharp lookout.
Uh-huh.
See, Jug? Maybe we can organize a searching party. You know, a manhunt.
You think so?
Sure.
Well, all right. But do you mind if I finish my breakfast first, Archie? I can't do much searching on an empty stomach.
All right, and I'll finish mine, too.
You do that, Archie.
Goodbye. I'll see you in 5 minutes.
Goodbye.
Now, Archie, I want you to keep out of trouble.
Oh, sure, Mom. I'm not going to do anything rash. Gee, if you don't have to worry, I'm just going to keep my eyes peeled. I can at least do that, can't I?
Yes, I suppose so.
And if accidentally I should happen to see the Nazi prisoner, the least thing I can do is to report him to the FBI. Isn't that right, Mom?
All right, Archie. Eat your breakfast.
Oh, boy. Wait till Veronica reads the headline. Local boy captures escaped Nazi single-handed.
Are you sure the paper said the escaped Nazi prisoner was in Riverdale, Archie?
Golly, would I be telling you a thing like that if I wasn't sure? Of course I'm sure.
Yeah, but the war with Germany is over.
What's that got to do with it, Jug? Gee whiz, the way you talk, anybody'd think you never read the papers. We still got Nazi prisoners, and when they escape, the FBI wants everybody to keep a sharp lookout for them.
Hello, Archie. Hello, Chuckhead.
Hello, Archie.
Hello, Veronica.
Hello, Betty. Did you read about the Nazi prisoner?
No.
Right after school, Archie and I are going to organize a hunting party to track him down.
Sure, we're going to capture him single-handed.
Oh, Archie, you're too funny for words.
I don't think that's so funny, Veronica. I don't think that's so funny.
I think it's hilarious.
Well, I don't.
Sure, you tell her, Betty.
I think it's a very good idea. And I'd like to come along, too. May I, Archie?
Well, I don't know. Manhunts aren't safe for girls.
I don't see why not.
Now, Betty, let's not argue. Let's not... Gee whiz.
What's the matter, Archie? Do you feel sick?
Gee whiz.
What's the matter, Archie? Do you have the cramps?
That's him.
Who?
That's him.
Where?
Over there, standing on the corner. The Nazi prisoner.
Oh, well, Archie, this is too silly. Come on, Betty, we'll be late for school.
No, you go ahead, Veronica. I want to see what happens.
Very well. Bye, Archie. And don't forget to write to me when you get to Washington. And be sure it's on FBI stationery.
All right, Veronica, all right. Maybe I will. FBI station.
Are you sure that's him, Archie?
Of course it's him. Didn't you read the description? I think we better do something before he gets away.
Oh, there he goes. He's walking up Linden Avenue.
Golly, that's right, he is.
What do we do now, Archie?
I think we better follow him.
Well, that's a good idea. You go first and I'll be right behind you, backing you up.
And I'll be right behind you, Jughead.
And I'll be right behind, right back. Oh, come on. Let's get started on our manhunt. But he's planning to hide in the high school.
What's he doing now, Archie? Can you see?
He's trying the door to the gym.
Oh, boy, maybe he's thinking of blowing up the school.
Oh, Jughead.
Oh, come on, Archie, we better go in. You know what happened the last time we were late. Mr. Weatherby...
Now, listen, Jughead, what's more important at a time like this, Mr. Weatherby or the Nazi prisoner? Gee, whiz, if we don't do something right away and let him blow up the school, there won't be a Mr. Weatherby.
What are we going to do, Archie?
I'm going to capture him.
How?
How? How?
Yes, how?
Don't rush me, Jughead. I'm trying to think.
Well, maybe he has a gun.
That's right, Archie. Anyway, it's 9:30.
All right. If you don't want to help me, then I'll do it alone.
Oh, of course we'll help you, Archie. Won't we, Jug?
Well, all right. We'll help you, Archie. What do you want us to do?
I don't know exactly.
Well, maybe we better tell Mr. Weatherby and let him do the capturing.
And let the Nazi escape in the meanwhile? Besides, what would Veronica think? I mean, gee whiz, I don't want her to think... Oh, I mean, I want to prove that I'm a...
We know what you mean, Archie.
You do? I mean, you do?
Yeah, we do. But I still want to know how you're going to capture him, Archie.
I got an idea. Why don't we tie him up?
Tie him up? With what?
With rope, of course. Hey, that's a good idea. Why didn't I think of it before? Betty, you go in the gym through the back way and get some rope. I think you'll find some underneath the benches on the far end. And get one of the football blankets.
What's that for?
To throw over his head, of course, so we won't see.
Oh.
Then all we have to do is sneak up behind him, tie him up, and then I'll go and get our car and we'll deliver him to the police.
You want me to go now, Archie?
Sure, and come back as soon as you can.
All right. I'll be back in 2 minutes.
Shh, he'll hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'll be back in 2 minutes.
Okay.
I still think it would be better to tell Mr. Weatherby and let him do the capturing.
Gee whiz, Jughead. Sometimes I think you're scared of your own shadow.
Who said I'm scared? Who?
I did.
You take that back, Archie Andrews.
I won't.
All right, Archie, if that's the way you feel about it, I'll just go inside and leave you here.
All right, go ahead. See if I care. Betty and I will do it alone.
All right. I'm going, Archie.
Go ahead. I don't care. And don't ever talk to me again, Jughead.
Not ever?
No.
Then give me back my quarter.
I haven't got your quarter. I'll give it to you tonight.
Archie, I've got the rope and the football blanket.
All right. Let's sneak up behind him.
Wait, Archie. I'm going with you.
Who said you could come, Jughead? Who said?
I did.
All right, then come on.
Gee, thanks, Archie.
Now,
Now he's walking to the front entrance.
I got an idea. You run in front of him, Betty, and distract his attention. Then Jughead and I'll rush up behind him, throw his blanket over him, and start tying him up.
All right. Goodbye, Archie. Remember me if I should get killed.
Sure, I will, Betty.
Yoo-hoo! Yoo-hoo! Fire Hitler! That's a friend!
Ah! Okay, I got him. All right, Jughead, stop tying him up. I'm going to drag him inside the gym. Oh, boy, wait till Veronica hears about this. Will she be surprised? We'll put him underneath the stand.
I can't. He's squirming too much.
Give me the shovel, Betty.
Don't hit him too hard, Archie. He won't be able to talk when they bring him to the police.
Don't worry. I'll just tap him.
Oh.
There. All right, Jughead. Let's carry him.
Boy, is he heavy.
Look out for the horizontal bars, Archie.
I can see them, Betty. I can see them.
Look out for the wrestling mats, Archie.
I am looking out for them, Jug.
Archie, my hands are giving way.
Hold on to him, Jug. All right. Now bring his feet up this way.
Okay.
We'll roll him under.
Oh, boy. I'm numb all over. You think we ought to tell Mr. Weatherby now so we can call the police?
Now, Jug, I told you we're going to take him down ourselves. Gee whiz, I got to show Veronica.
It's 10 o'clock, Archie.
It is? Gee, I better hurry up and get the car. You and Betty stay here, Jughead, and watch him.
Me, Archie, me? All alone with the Nazi prisoner?
Well, gee whiz, you'll have Betty here.
But she's a girl, Archie.
I resent that, Jughead.
You resent that you're a girl?
I resent your saying.
Well, that's a fine thing, Betty, when a man
can't... Oh, tie a can on it, Jug. Now, you wait here until I get back. And if he starts squirming again, don't take any chances. Just use the shovel.
Don't worry, Archie. When we get through with him, he'll look like a victory garden.
Hello? Hello?
Hello.
Hello, Fred.
Yes, is this you, Mary? I've been calling you for the past hour. Where have you been?
Well, I've been at the day nursery. And, Fred, I have bad news for you.
Oh, look, Mary, I have no time for that. Have you seen Mr. Hotchkiss anywhere?
Who?
Mr. Hotchkiss. Mr. Hotchkiss.
I can hear you. Don't shout,
Mary. I'm not shouting. He wasn't on the train. They said in the capital that they took an earlier train, but he's nowhere in town. I thought maybe he'd come out to our house by mistake.
No, dear, he's not here. Fred, I have something to tell you.
Mary, if it has anything to do with Archie, I can't listen now. I must find Mr. Hotchkiss. If he's wandering around town somewhere with nobody to talk to, I'll be disgraced for life.
I'm sure your Mr. Hotchkiss will turn up somewhere. Now, Fred...
Mary, I am very busy. I'll have to call the police.
The police? How did you know?
How did I know what?
That our car's stolen.
Without having the exhaust fixed? What? Stolen?
Yes.
You mean it's not in the garage?
No, dear. The garage doors were wide open and the car's gone.
Well, why didn't you tell me that before, Mary? You're
well,
I talked to you on the phone for the past half hour and you didn't mention a thing about the car being stolen.
But I've been trying to tell you.
Now, Mary, let's not argue again, dear. We'll let bygones be bygones. I'll have to notify the police immediately.
Yes, you do that, Fred.
If you hear anything about Mr. Hotchkiss, you let me know at once.
If I hear anything about Mr. Hotchkiss, well, goodbye, Fred. I think I'm going to lie down.
What's the matter? Are you sick, Mary?
No, but I'm going to be if another thing gets lost or stolen.
Hey, take it easy, Archie. You nearly hit that car.
I saw him. You don't have to tell me how to drive.
He's wriggling again, Archie.
Oh, gee whiz. Keep the tire over him.
I am, but he's wriggling anyway.
Let's hit him again with the shovel.
Now, take it easy, Jug. We got to bring him in good condition.
Well, he's not in such good condition anymore. Hey, watch out for that car, Archie.
I'm watching it. Gee whiz, I can't do everything. Oh, boy.
Now you did it, Archie. I told you to watch out.
Golly.
Here comes the driver of the car you hit.
Oh, golly.
He's carrying a monkey wrench.
You sure fixed it, Archie. It's 12 o'clock. We haven't been to school, and you just crashed into a car. We have a Nazi prisoner tied up in the back. Boy, are we going to get it?
What's the charge, Mike?
Well, please, Chief Klink, I can explain. You see, we were on our way here anyway with the prisoner.
What prisoner?
The Nazi prisoner, the one we captured. We were bringing him in.
That's a fine cock and bull story. You're not going to get off with excuses like that, young fellow.
But, Chief, you can look for yourself. He's in the back of the car.
Did you see anything in the back of the car, Mike?
Nothing, Chief, except an old blanket, a tire, and a shovel.
But that's what I mean. I mean, that's him.
That's enough out of you. Go ahead, Mike.
I demand justice. These kids are deliberately and maliciously...
And that's enough out of you, too. Now, go ahead, Mike.
Well, it was about 11:27 a.m. Or maybe it was a little later, maybe a little sooner.
Go on.
Well, I was walking my beat as usual, except that I stopped in the cigar store on the corner of Fountain Avenue to investigate a complaint about a noise that a woman made because she says there was unnecessary disturbance.
Get to the point, Mike.
Well, the point is, this young fellow here smacked his car into this guy here, and he had no driver's license.
That's right. And I demand that these kids be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law.
Now, just a minute.
Please, Chief Clink, you gotta listen. The Nazi prisoner.
Now, just a minute, young man.
I demand that these kids be punished. It's getting so it ain't safe.
Now, but just a minute, mister.
Mr. Clink. Archie's telling you the truth, and...
Now,
well, golly,
just a minute, miss.
He tried to allay for school, and Mr. Weatherby...
Now, just a minute there.
He can even call my father and ask...
Quiet! Quiet! You too, Mike.
Yes.
Now, let's get to the bottom of this.
If you'll only call my father...
I intend to do that. And furthermore, I intend to call the judge, and the truant officer, and the principal of your school.
Mr. Weatherby, will that be necessary, Chief?
It will be.
Oh.
Hello? Chief Clink speaking. Yes? Oh, yes, Mr. Andrews.
Oh, boy.
What's the serial number? Z2365J. A black sedan with a dent in the front fender. Stolen this morning.
Chief, that's the car with these kids. That's the license number.
Just a minute. What did you say, Mike?
I said that's the car those kids were driving.
Are you sure?
Look at the registration card.
Quite a coincidence, Mr. Andrews. We just caught your car thieves. Three of them. And your car is right here in front of the police station. Yes, an accident. Ran into another car. Yes, sir, Mr. Andrews. We'll hold them, all right.
Mr. Clink, I mean, Chief, we can explain. I mean, I can
explain.
Has
that going to be enough excuses out of you? Mike?
Yes, sir?
Lock them up.
Yes, sir.
Oh, Mr. Weatherby, this is Mr. Andrews.
How do you do, Mr. Andrews? I'm glad you called. I want to speak to you about Archie. He has...
Not now, Mr. Weatherby. Later. I want to speak to you about Mr. Hotchkiss.
What about Mr. Hotchkiss?
Have you seen him?
No. Isn't he with you?
No.
That's peculiar. Did anything happen to him?
That's what I'd like to know. Oh, Mr. Lodge, this is Mr. Andrews.
Oh, hello, Andrews. I've been waiting for you and Mr. Hotchkiss. Where are you?
Mr. Hotchkiss didn't by any chance come directly to you, did he?
Why, no. Isn't he with you?
No.
Why, what happened to him?
That's what I'd like to know.
Hello?
Hello, Mary. Did you hear anything?
About what, dear?
About Mr. Hotchkiss.
No, Fred.
Oh, dog.
Don't swear, Fred.
I didn't swear. I only said doggone it.
Well, don't say it. Fred, have you called his office in the Capitol?
I called it three times and I sent three telegrams. They keep insisting he's right here in Riverdale.
Well, how could he be in Riverdale when he isn't in Riverdale?
That's what I'd like to know.
What time is it, Archie?
2:00.
Oh, boy.
Gosh, it sure is cold in this jail.
Wait till Archie's father gets here and finds out it's us. He'll be warm enough then.
Do you have to remind me, Jug? Do you have to remind me?
He's your father, isn't he?
Sure.
And it's his car, isn't it?
Sure.
And it was your idea, capturing the prisoner, wasn't it?
I know it, Jug. I know it.
All right, then I'll keep reminding you.
No.
Your father is sure taking his time about getting here, Archie.
And that's a fine thing. That's all I have to say. We start out by capturing a Nazi prisoner. We end up prisoners ourselves. That's a fine thing, Archie Andrews.
All right, Mr. Andrews. I'm glad we have the situation straightened out.
Yes, Chief. Thank you very much.
Goodbye, Mr. Andrews.
Goodbye, Chief.
All right, Archie, come along. I want to talk to you in private.
Yes, Dad. I'll be glad to.
It wasn't his fault, Mr. Andrews.
He was only doing his duty, Mr. Andrews.
We'll talk about that later, Betty. Now, where's the car?
In front of the police station where the sergeant left it. And the Nazi prisoner's lying in the back.
Oh, Archie, I told you I don't want to hear any more nonsense about the Nazi prisoner. When you get home, you will receive your proper punishment, both from me and Mr. Weatherby.
Yes, Dad.
Oh, all right. Where's the car?
It's right. Why, it's right. Standing in front of... Well, gee whiz. What do you know? It's been stolen again.
Quiet, Joe, or I will put a bullet through your head right now. You stupid Americans, you are all the same. Soft, no brains. You will find out soon enough that you have not won the war. Now, listen carefully. I am going to drive into that shed at the end of the road. Then I am going to untie ropes and we will change clothes. But I want to warn you of one thing. If you make the least sound, I will kill you, you understand? On the other hand, maybe we won't change clothes. No. I will just take yours and put you out on the highway in your underwear. Yeah, that will be funny. That will be very funny. A real American joke.
You say your car was right in front of the police station and it was stolen?
Sure. Don't you remember? Your man put it there himself.
And I'm a witness.
So am I.
No, just a minute. Just a minute. Nobody can steal a car from in front of a police station. That's unheard of.
That's what you say.
No, just a minute, Mr. Andrews. There must be some mistake. We'll get this matter straightened out.
Well, you'd better get it straightened out, officer, or I'll sue the city.
No, look here, Mr. Andrews. You can't go around threatening a police officer.
I'm not threatening any police officer. I want my car.
Now, keep calm, Mr. Andrews. We're going to check.
I am calm.
Maybe we ought to organize a search.
That'll be enough out of you, Archie. You've caused enough trouble for one day.
Oh, boy. Here comes Mr. Lodge. Now he'll tell Veronica.
There you are, Andrews.
Oh, Mr. Lodge, I've been meaning to get in touch with you about Mr. Hotchkiss.
Precisely what I want to talk to you about. Andrews, no. I appointed you a committee of one to meet Mr. Hotchkiss and take him through the school.
Yeah, but...
And now you've gone and lost him.
I have not lost him. I haven't even seen him.
I am not interested in your explanation, Andrews. You were supposed to meet Mr. Hotchkiss, and here I find you in the police station.
My car was stolen.
That is no excuse.
Quiet!
Shut up!
Yes, sir.
Now, go ahead. What are you saying? Yes? Yes. Oh, is that so? Okay, we'll investigate at once. Well, okay, Mr. Andrews, your car's been located. We just got a report that it was seen on the main highway heading north.
What?
And a Nazi prisoner was driving it.
A Nazi prisoner in my car?
That's what I've been trying to tell you.
Yeah, he must have been tied his ropes.
Well, what are we waiting for? Come on, let's go.
Andrews.
What?
How about Hotchkiss?
I haven't got Hotchkiss. I haven't seen Hotchkiss. I spent all morning looking for him, and I spent the whole afternoon looking for him. And I've made 100 phone calls, and I've sent out 10 telegrams. He wasn't on the train, and he's not in the Capitol. He's not in Riverdale. And what's more, I don't care if he never gets here. I am sick of Hotchkiss, and I'm sick of you too, Lodge. And if you want an annex, you can build it yourself. Now put that in your Hotchkiss and smoke it.
Now, you American pig, come out. Come out. So, I will take off your ropes now. Remember what I told you. If you let out even the smallest whisper, I will kill you. Now, we will take off the blanket.
This is an outrage.
Silence. Now start taking off your clothes.
No, never. I'll...
Do you see this gun? I can assure you I will not hesitate to use it. Remember, my friend, I am a Nazi. We Nazis do not make empty threats. Now, remove your clothes. It's so hot in here.
You'll pay for this. You and everybody in this town, particularly those nasty kids.
Don't talk so much. You are wasting time.
I feel so sleepy. I guess it is because... Yeah. Here are the pants.
All right. Now start with your other. I think I will sit down.
Yeah. So will I.
Don't try to run away. I can see you.
Well, I can see you. You too.
Yes.
for miles. He must have gotten away.
Gotten away? In my car?
Look. Look, officer. The tire marks on the side of the road.
Mike, slow down.
Okay, Chief.
Yeah, they lead to that shed. All right, Mike, pull in.
Okay.
Yeah, looks like maybe we got something here. Now, careful, everybody. This man's dangerous.
We're right behind you, Chief.
Yeah, right behind you, Chief.
Oh, boy, this is exciting.
Now, come on, Mike. Give me a hand with this door.
Okay.
All right. Come out with your hands up. We got your cut. What the devil?
Hey, there he is. He's asleep on the floor.
His blanket's off.
And he's lost his pants.
Oh, look, Arch. There's another one. There are two of them.
Yeah, this car is still running. Carbon monoxide must have knocked them both out.
Yes, there's something wrong with the exhaust, Chief.
All right, Mike. Let's bring him outside.
Right behind you, Chief.
Come on, Jughead. Let's give him a hand.
Okay.
Okay. Drop him here. Hey, come on. Come on. Snap out of it. Come on, you.
Where am I?
Why, Mr. Hotchkiss.
Hotchkiss? Who's Hotchkiss?
This gentleman. He's the representative in the governor's office. We've been looking for him all day.
Oh, boy.
Then this other bird must be the escaped Nazi.
Oh, my head.
Oh, Mr. Hotchkiss, what happened?
Those kids.
Huh? That's them. They kidnapped me.
Oh, boy.
Archie, I think I'm going home. I just remembered something I had to do right away.
Oh, I don't understand, Mr. Hotchkiss. I mean, finding you here. We've been looking for you all day about the annex.
Andrews, I want you to know that after what these kids have done to me, I'll never consent to an annex. Oh. Never. Look at my hair. It's half gone.
Oh, boy.
Can't we go home, Archie?
Mr. Hotchkiss, if you will only tell us what happened.
I'll tell you what happened. After I have those kids arrested for assault and battery and kidnapping.
Oh, boy.
Well, Archie, what do you know about this?
Me, Dad? Me?
You explain yourself at once.
I'll tell you what they did. They kidnapped me from in front of the school. They beat me over the head with a shovel.
Mr. Hotchkiss, here are your pants. Mm-mm. And let me shake your hand.
What? Shake my hand? What for? Is this another trick?
Capturing that Nazi prisoner must have been quite a job.
But I never...
Now, no need being modest, Mr. Hotchkiss. You deserve all the credit.
I do?
Of course. You'll be a national hero. Pictures in all the papers.
of course, it was a rather difficult job.
You bet. Say, how did you ever do it? Did you know he had a gun?
Oh, of course. He threatened me with it. But I just said to myself, Hotchkiss, it's your duty to do the patriotic thing and hold your ground.
Well, I want to shake your hand, sir. It isn't every day that you have a chance to meet a hero in person.
Yes, yes.
Archie, we are going home, and when we get there, there are certain things...
Oh, now, look, Andrews, look, don't be too rough on the boy.
I'll handle this in my own way, Mr. Hotchkiss. I can assure you he will get his full and just punishment. And I'll notify the parents of the other two.
Now, Andrews, don't be pig-headed. Kids will be kids, you know.
But I thought you wanted...
Never mind what you thought. Forget it. And don't stand there gaping. Give me my pants so we can go back into town and talk about your annex.
Well, thank you, Mr. Hotchkiss.
Golly!
Well, that wraps up another visit to Riverdale with Archie Andrews, his family, and his friends. But they'll be with us again next week, same time, same station. So be on hand, won't you? There'll be plenty of fun and excitement.
Hey, Chuck, listen.
Yeah, here I am, Arch. I'm still here.
Look, Chuck, I'm in a very difficult spot. You gotta help me out. You gotta.
Okay. What now?
Well, I got things all straightened out with Veronica, kind of, but she's still sort of sore at me. And I got it straightened out about the dance with Betty. She said it was okay if I went with Veronica. But Mom says I still gotta go on the picnic with Betty. Only Veronica's gonna come along, too, with you.
Relax, Archie. Relax.
Today's Archie Andrews script was written by Ben Kagan and is based on a copyrighted feature appearing in Archie Comics magazine. The music was composed and conducted by Leo Kempinski, and the entire production was under the direction of Anton M. Leader. This is Ken Banghart saying, have a pleasant weekend. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
That was the first episode of Archie Andrews from June 23, 1945, called Nazi POW in Riverdale, as broadcasted on the Mutual Radio Network. Opening in 1875, the Crime Museum at Scotland Yard is the oldest museum in the world purely for recording crime. The name Black Museum was coined in 1877 by a reporter from The Observer, a London newspaper, although the museum is still referred to as the Crime Museum. It is this museum that inspired the Black Museum radio series, produced in London by Harry Allen Towers. From Jay Hickerson's The Ultimate History of Network Radio Programming and Guide to All Circulating Shows, the earliest U.S. broadcast date was January 1, 1952. 39 shows, from the full syndication of 52 shows, aired over mutual stations from January 1, 1952 through June 24, 1952 and September 30, 1952 through December 30, 1952. This may be the earliest broadcast of the series worldwide. It was later broadcast over Radio Luxembourg starting May 7, 1953. Radio Luxembourg broadcast sponsored programs at night to England. The BBC was state-owned and had no commercials. The shows were sponsored by Draft & Miro, cleaning products. The series continued to be offered in syndication and was heard on AFR's broadcasts and in the US on NPR stations through the 1960s, 70s and 80s. Some shows were broadcast by the BBC in England in 1994. This murder mystery series was based on true life cases from Scotland Yard's files. Each episode was based on an item or items of evidence in the museum. Orson Welles hosted and narrated the shows. Mr. Welles opened each show slightly differently but followed a standard format. For example, the show, The Bathtub, opened as follows. This is Orson Welles speaking from London. Big Ben starts hymning in the background. The Black Museum, repository of death. Here, in this grim stone structure on the Thames which houses Scotland Yard, is a warehouse of homicide, where everyday objects, a piece of wire, a chemist's flask, a silver shilling, all are touched by murder. Dramatic music following the opening, Mr. Welles would introduce the museum's item or items of evidence that was central to the case, leading into the dramatization. He also provided narration during the show and ended each show with his characteristic closing from the days of his Mercury Theatre of the Air, remaining obediently yours. Harry Allen Towers produced the series from scripts written by Ira Marion. Music was composed and conducted by Sidney Torch. The museum was not open to the general public. Its purpose was then, and still is, for police training, although it did receive a considerable number of famous people, including Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. It is currently used as a lecture theater for the police and like bodies in various subjects of criminology. But, thanks to Mr. Towers and Mr. Welles, we can still get a glimpse of what secrets are housed in the Black Museum. Here is an episode called, The Bathtub.
This is Orson Welles, speaking from London. The Black Museum, a repository of death. Here in the grim stone structure on the Thames, which houses Scotland Yard, is a warehouse of homicide, where everyday objects, a piece of wire, a chemist's flask, a silver shilling, all are touched by murder. Here's a bathtub. It's a familiar object. This is an old-fashioned one, a ball and claw-footed bathtub without plumbing connections. It's the kind our fathers and mothers knew about. Into this they poured the Saturday night water by hand. Some liked it cool. Others liked it hot.
There we are, dear. Is that hot enough?
If you think so, darling. Oh, you're the sweetest. I wonder how I had the luck to marry you.
Part of my job, dear, taking care of you. And one day soon, we shall have a tub with taps. One of the new ones. You'll see.
Well, today, the bathtub can be found in the Black Museum.
From the annals of the Criminal Investigation Department of the London Police, we bring you the dramatic stories of the crimes recorded by the objects in Scotland Yard's Gallery of Death, the Black Museum. In just a moment, you will hear The Black Museum, starring Orson Welles.
Thank you.
The Black Museum, starring Orson Welles.
Here we are. Here we are in the Black Museum. Scotland Yard's mausoleum of murder. Here lies death. Like the ordered rows of markers in a military cemetery, the white cards of the black printing line the silent shelves, the cabinets, the crowded floor, each card identifying a means to murder. A lovely wine glass here, beautiful ringing crystal. Yet in that sound was terror. In this glass was poison and horrible writhing death. Now here we are, here's the bathtub. So innocent, even comical. Basis for a thousand jokes, foundation for laughter, circa 1910. No plumbing attached, of course. One poured the water in from buckets and pitchers. Truly an effort, the use of such a tub as this. Definitely a matter for an interior, not for an exterior. Certainly not for a garden like this, where in the peaceful year of 1910, Edward Jones read aloud to his wife, Evelyn.
Friendship is constant in all other things, save in the office and affairs of love. Therefore, all hearts in love use their own tongues. Let every eye negotiate for itself and trust no agent. For beauty is a witch against whose charms faith melteth into blood. This is an accident of hourly proof which I mistrusted not. That's Shakespeare's Much Ado About Nothing, my dear. Like it?
You read so well, Eddie, darling. So well.
I do like it here, Evelyn. I wish nothing ever interrupted us. But, as the bard said, the world is too much with us.
You make that sound as if you were going off on another trip. Are you, darling?
I'm afraid so. That case for Mr. Carter, the Ming Dynasty cherry water bottle, remember? I've heard of one up north. Oh, dear, I wish I could run an antique shop without these interminable trips. But I suppose there's nothing for it.
Too bad. Poor Eddie, poor Evelyn, separated so often and for such long periods. But business is business, and a living must be made. Eddie bids his wife a fond farewell and proceeds on his way to a middle-sized city. And there he walks the street, enjoying the sunshine and the crowd, when suddenly...
Ed! Oh, Ed, darling. Oh, at last, after all these months. Oh, Ed!
Wait, what... Anne, oh, my darling.
Oh, Eddie, oh, it's been so long and no word. I thought you might be dead.
Of course not, darling, like the bad penny. Why, I was hoping against hope I'd find you any minute. I went back to our place, but you're gone. A new landlady, no information.
Oh, but what happened, darling? You never wrote, and I waited and waited.
Yes, it was an accident, darling. Blow on the head. Amnesia. Only a few days ago, I came back to myself.
Oh, my poor darling.
No matter, darling Annie. We are back together. Once again, we are husband and wife.
So that's the little game, is it? A wife in every city, is it? Well now, Mr. Edward Jones, what's the idea? What can this get you, besides a heap of trouble and stiff prison sentence? What can it get you?
There we are, Anne, my dear. I've signed mine. Now you sign yours. You see? Ladies are first, except in getting off trolley cars or signing wills.
Oh, Eddie, you are sweet. There we are. Now, oh, heaven forbid, anything happens to you, all you have is mine. And vice versa, if anything should happen to me.
Heaven forbid, Anne, my dear.
Well, apparently it can get you plenty. If your wife has plenty, and Anne was, well, decently off with a needy income from her father's estate, although she was not allowed to touch the principal. However, there was a proviso concerning her husband's rights. If and when.
I'm horribly upset about it, Doctor. Here she is, apparently in perfect health. She has an awful fit, and all she remembers about it is a slight headache. She's my wife, Doctor.
These things happen, Mr. Jameson, I can assure you.
Oh. So Eddie Jones is Eddie Jemison hereabouts. That's interesting.
Nothing. I found absolutely nothing physiologically wrong with Mrs. Jameson. She's in perfect physical health. Now then.
But how can I be, Doctor, when I have these terrible fits?
Well, such things even we doctors don't know yet, my dear. Such as the reaction of the human mind to great stress. And you've been through such stress with Mr. Jameson missing so long.
But what can we do about it, Dr. Margotson?
Oh, just rest, relaxation, quiet, peace. Most important, relaxation. Now, I'll prescribe a mild sedative each night before sleeping.
So simple, so easy, so diabolical, and so considerate. No, Anne, darling, you mustn't even fetch your own bathwater.
There we are, almost full. And nice and warm. Just right to relax in, just as the doctor ordered.
Oh, Eddie, I don't know why you do all this for me. I don't do half as much for you.
You do, darling, just by being. You know that, don't you?
No, I say it 100 times a day. Eddie, you're sweet.
All right, my dear. Now step in. I'll help you. Take care. The water may be hot and the tub may be slippery. There we are, dear. That hot enough?
If you think so, darling. Oh, you're the sweetest. Oh, I wonder how I had the luck to marry you.
Part of my job, dear. Taking care of you. And one day soon we shall have a tub with taps. One of the new ones. You'll see. Ready to sit down, darling?
Quite a pair of lovebirds, Anne and Eddie Jameson Jones. No wonder the poor fellow could hardly contain himself some 30 minutes later.
I went out for a minute to make the tea. Doctor, how could she go so quickly?
It is strange. Well, certainly an accident.
I barely turned my back, just put some water on in the tea kettle. And when I returned, there she was, floating face down in the water. Doctor, can't you help her?
Calm yourself, my boy. Your wife is past help now.
Such tragedy, such tears, and a will by which Eddie came into something over £800. In 1910, that was a fair amount of money. Enough for a man to live on with his wife for quite some time. While he read Shakespeare aloud in a quiet garden.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's lease hath all too short a date. Evelyn, how you stand for me for all my absences, I hardly know.
I suppose I love you, dear. You are nice, and you're a good provider. So until you come back, I'm always content to wait. Go on. Read some more, darling.
Yes. Yes, of course. Nor shall death brag thou wanderest in his shade, when in eternal lines to time thou growest. So long as men can breathe or eyes can see, so long as...
Nor shall death brag, the young man read aloud, but where were his thoughts on his next trip? On the story he would invent? And which story? To which woman? His ever faithful Evelyn? Or young Libby, whom he took to wife some 2 months later?
So this is the bride, Mr. Jameson.
This is Mrs. Jameson. Isn't he lovely?
Oh, Eddie, stop it. We're only married a few hours, and you're embarrassing me already.
My deepest apologies, darling. Are our quarters ready?
Oh, they certainly are. I'll have my boy help you with the bags. It's not every night we have a bride and groom in this house, you know.
No, not every night. This promised to be eventful indeed, particularly if you knew Eddie Jameson Jones.
Oh, Mrs. Brundy.
Yes, Mr. Jameson?
I hate to bother you, but could we have enough hot water for a warm bath? My wife hasn't been well. Some kind of spell, almost a fit. Took her to a doctor yesterday.
Oh, dear. And so young she is.
Nothing serious. Just needs relaxation. That's what the doctor said. She insisted on going through with the wedding, even though I thought it might be better to postpone it. So a good warm bath. Nothing quite so relaxing, is there?
I'll set the fire going right away. You shall have all...
Oh, yes. Aria da capo. Repeat the theme. This time with a variation. And the variation was a bag of tomatoes.
Mr. Jameson, I didn't hear you go out.
I just ran out while my wife was in the tub. Picked up some tomatoes. Fried tomatoes are her favorite dish. And I thought, well, tonight of all nights, she ought to have them. If you don't mind fixing them, Mrs. Brandy.
It'll be a pleasure, Mr. Jameson. I'll have them ready with your dinner, never fear.
It's me, Libby, darling. I'm back. Libby. Libby, are you there? Good heavens. Mrs. Brumby, help! My wife! My wife is floating face down in the tub! She's dead! My wife is dead!
And today, you can see that same bathtub in the Black Museum.
In just a moment, we will continue with The Black Museum, starring Orson Welles. We continue with The Black Museum, starring Orson Welles.
Yes, the girl was dead, floating in the bathtub, face down, just as Anne before her. And Eddie? He was stricken, heartbroken, as a bridegroom ought to be.
My poor Libby. To die alone like that on her wedding night. So good, so sweet, so eager for life, and so in love with me. Even insured her life for me just before we married, as if she had a premonition almost.
£750 insurance is a comfortable sum. Man and his wife can live in their garden quite decently with a sum like that for quite a few months in 1910. But it seems one can grow a trifle bored, even with a garden and Shakespeare.
How do you feel now, dear?
A slight headache, that's all. It'll go away.
Evelyn, you've got to go back to the doctor or find a new doctor. A slight headache, that's how your fit started yesterday.
No, he's not trying the same thing again. But he seems to be. Of course, he's had two quite successfully accidental deaths in his life so far. Perhaps a third? But that's not possible. Or is it?
Almost ready, Evelyn?
In a minute, dear.
Better come while the water's hot. You know what the doctor said about relaxing? Hurry now, darling. It's steaming, but not too hot. All ready, dear?
All right, dear. There's not that much hurry. Oh, dear. Who's that now?
Wait for me, darling. I'll help you get in. The tub may be slippery. One day we'll have a modern tub with taps and hot and cold running water. You'll see. Now, don't try to get in without me.
All right, dear, I'll wait for you.
Yes? Are you Edward Jones?
I am.
We're police officers from Scotland Yard. We have a warrant for your arrest. The charge is murder. I must warn you that anything you say may be taken down in writing and used in evidence. Please come quietly.
No, Evelyn Jones never took that bath. She never had another fit, either. Though she sat in the courtroom for the entire trial. The trial of the Crown versus Edward Jones, also known as Edward Jemison.
May it please your lordship, gentlemen of the jury, This is a peculiar case. No one saw this man commit the crime of which he stands accused. Yet every circumstance, every bit of evidence points to the fact that this man stands justly accused and deserves proper punishment. Now, in the course of this trial, you will hear many things about love, about coincidence, about accidental...
Oh, yes, they heard many things, that jury, sitting so stiff and serious-minded in its box. Not the least was the opening of the famous defense counsel who held the brief for Edward Jones, also known as Jemison.
Nor will we deny that this man may have married bigamously, but he did love these poor women, and it was a far, far better thing he did in marrying them than to lead them astray and then leave them alone with remorse, as so many men have done before him. We deny that my client killed these poor women. We claim only that he was the victim of a set of circumstances and the interference of a busybody. Yes, a male busybody.
A male busybody? Well, perhaps. But how could a policeman, in the proper course of his duty, fail to check on so obvious a coincidence?
Yes, sir. We had a letter at Scotland Yard from a Mr. John Curtis. What were the contents of that letter, Sergeant?
Mr. Curtis had noticed a brief announcement in the newspapers regarding the death of a young woman, a bride, by drowning in the bathtub. He wished to call our attention to a similar accident some time before. In both cases, the name was Jemison.
You saw this letter yourself?
I did.
Is this the same letter?
It is, sir.
I offer this letter in evidence, Your Lordship, as Crown Exhibit A.
It went on like that, slowly, carefully, plugging all the holes as they went along. The details of a routine police investigation which suddenly had become a little more than routine.
Sergeant Mason, when you visited the scene of the first drowning, what did you learn?
That the man known as Jemison had mentioned two wills. One by himself in favor of his wife, one by his wife in favor of himself. We checked the files of the probate court. The latter had been probated. We called on the lawyer involved. He had a copy of the other will. The man known as Jemison, the deceased, had had quite a bit.
And when you visited the scene of the second drowning, Sergeant?
We learned that the man known as Jemison had mentioned an insurance policy in his own favor. We inquired of all the insurance companies and found the records. He had received some £750 following the death of the young...
The first point established. Motive. Money. Over £800 from Anne. £750 from Libby. Almost £2,000 in all. That's a substantial motive. The questioning of Sergeant Mason went on.
Now, in the matter of tracing this man, Jameson, what did you do?
Just routine, sir. We checked the mailing address at the insurance company and found it to be the same as the house where the second woman had died. There, we discovered a forwarding address, a postal box. We covered that box. I watched it myself, sir. And when this man known as Jemison came to open it, I followed him. He went first to an antique shop, then to his home. Having located him, I made some quiet inquiries and learned that he was known as Edward Jones. Now, that evening, having communicated with Inspector Wilson at the yard and having received a proper warrant, we placed him under arrest.
Very good, Sergeant. Now then, when you called upon Edward Jones, what did you find?
The woman who claimed to be his proper wife was waiting upstairs, sir, for him to help her into a hot bath.
One further question, Sergeant. Is the man you arrested in this courtroom now?
Yes, sir. He is the prisoner and the doctor.
Thank you, Sergeant. Thank you very
much. Oh, they'd been very thorough, all right. They had almost everything. They called Dr. Margetson, for instance.
Dr. Margetson, when you first saw Anne Jameson, what was her complaint?
That she'd been having fits and not remembering them.
Did she tell you this herself?
No, her husband did. He was quite insistent on it.
Did you find any symptoms of illness, sir?
I examined the woman very thoroughly. I found nothing. But that situation is not uncommon in certain types of epilepsy.
Now then, Doctor, when you were called to the house on the evening of June the 3rd last, what did you find?
The woman I had examined was floating face down in the warm bath and quite dead. The husband was extremely hysterical. I treated him for shock.
Did you sign this death certificate?
Yes, that's my signature.
What is certified as the cause of death?
Accidental drowning.
We offer this certificate in evidence as Crown...
They had the landlady who knew Libby Jemison, too. She testified, simply.
Oh, yes, sir. He moaned about the insurance policy. Cried all night, he did.
Bit by bit, piece by piece, motive, opportunity, proof of death by drowning, medical evidence. But one great piece of the puzzle remained, as the distinguished counsel for the defense asked.
Where, my lad, is the proof that these two regrettable deaths were anything more than coincidental accidents? Where, my lad, is the witness who saw my client hold these poor women under the water, or administer sedatives which caused them to faint in the water, or in any way contribute directly to their miserable death?
There was no witness.
But there was a Scotland Yard inspector with a demonstrable theory.
If it please your lordship, 3 bathtubs have been entered in evidence as Crown Exhibits C, D, and E. Inspector Maurice Wilson of Scotland Yard has a theory which he wishes to demonstrate as a witness, and he requires the assistance of an expert. Milad.
The inspector took the stand, was sworn in. Then, to the amusement of the spectators, a young lady in bathing dress, testified to as an expert swimmer, was introduced into the proceedings. One of the tubs was filled with water, warm water. At this point, the prosecutor stated,
"For the assurance of the court, we have a doctor in attendance. Now then, Inspector, if you please, you may leave the witness box and proceed with your demonstration."
"Thank you, sir. It is our considered theory that the murders were committed as follows. You will remember that in each case, the prisoner reported he found his wife floating face down. It is reasonable to assume that had the women fainted while sitting or lying in the tubs, they would have been found floating face up. With this in mind, it occurred to us that with the prisoner's insistence on helping his wife into the tub, the procedure was something like this. May I, young lady?"
"Of course, Inspector."
"Notice she is standing in the water. Now, prepare to sit down, please. Observe that she bends forward, grasps the side of the bathtub. I seize her ankles thus, and she falls forward on her face."
"Doctor, please, Inspector, get her out of that tub. The girl's unconscious. Get her out before her lungs fill and she drowns."
Some hours later, the jury reported.
"We have reached a verdict, my lord. We find the prisoner guilty of willful and premeditated murder."
"Well, that same bathtub is where you'd expect to find it today. In the Black Museum."
Orson Welles will be back with you in just a moment. Person is Orson Welles.
Eddie Jones, in spite of his common name, was an uncommon man. Some said he was quite mad. His own defense counsel stated later that when Eddie looked at him with his piercing stare, he felt as if the prisoner were trying to hypnotize him. This, of course, we'll never know. We can only wonder if those poor women were truly hypnotized by Eddie's eyes or merely by his charm and personality. In any case, one woman did not succumb to that charm for long. She was Eddie's real wife, the predecessor of Evelyn. This woman was swindled by Eddie, but found him out and sent him to prison for 2 years. Eddie swore to kill her. She fled to Canada when Eddie left prison that time. But she came back to England and was in the court the day Eddie Jones was sentenced to hang. And now, until we meet next time, till we meet in the same place and I tell you another story about the Black Museum, I remain, as always, obediently yours.
That was The Black Museum, starring Orson Welles in an episode called The Bathtub. In an earlier time, just prior to and following the Second World War, the general public was fascinated by the subject of crime. Numerous magazines of true crime stories filled the newsstands. Radio also helped fill the need with fictional heroes such as Johnny Dollar and the Saint. Few true crime dramas, other than Gangbusters or Dragnet, sustained long-term success on radio. The Secrets of Scotland Yard was a successful crime drama series, initially airing internationally between 1949 and 1951. Selected episodes finally came to a U.S. radio network for a brief run much later in 1957 over the Mutual Broadcasting System. The series boasted well over 100 episodes, one of which, The Bone from a Voice Box, apparently served as the prototype for another well-remembered Towers of London dramatic series, The Black Museum. In both series, well-known actors were employed as host, narrator, Orson Welles in The Black Museum and Clive Brook here. In fact, the shows were so similar that some of the same actual Scotland Yard cases were dramatized for both series, with totally different scripts and casts. The Secrets of Scotland Yard was an independent production of the Towers of London syndicate in England for worldwide distribution. Each week, an audience of anxious radio listeners tuned in to hear these true crime stories of the London Metropolitan Police unfold, as the detectives at the Yard investigated some of England's most famous criminals. Their trials have become legendary. Stories presented in the series include the theft of the British Crown Jewels by Colonel Thomas Blood, the story of a man who finds an armless and legless body wrapped in ribbons and lace, or the strange story of two close brothers who love one another enough to contemplate the murder of a brother's affluent, yet unsightly and ignorant, wife. Murders, forgery, and robberies all get a through review on the program. Each time, Scotland Yard detectives are afoot to solve the crime mystery. The Secrets of Scotland Yard was initially hosted by Clive Brook, probably for the first year or so. To add to the air of authenticity, Brook sometimes discusses matters with Percy Hoskins, a 1950s crime expert and reporter for the London Daily Express. Hoskins knew every nook and cranny in London's seedier districts and personally reported on many of the major crimes of the day. A student of crime, Hoskins was also one of the founders of the Saints and Sinners Club of London, an educational organization dedicated to true crime investigation methods and results. Brook had his own Scotland Yard experience previously when he played retired naval commander Stevenson in the 1936 film, Scotland Yard Commands. American audiences will, however, probably more familiar with Brooks's portrayal of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's Sherlock Holmes in the 1932 film of the same name. Brook was eventually replaced by an actor portraying the character Superintendent the 10th of Scotland Yard. From Secrets of Scotland Yard, here is one of my favorite stories of Burke and Hare.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Secrets of Scotland Yard with your host and narrator, Clive Brook. Brought to you by the Mutual Broadcasting System in cooperation with the Kraft Foods Company, makers of Velveeta, the quality pasteurized processed cheese spread. Ex-lax.
How do you do? What would make you commit a murder? What motive? Love? Hate? Jealousy? Greed? Murders by madmen don't count. They have no motive. But quite sane people have destroyed human life for reasons both extraordinary and unpredictable. How interesting and exciting are the vagaries of human nature, in proof of which I'm going to recall to life a little scene of murder that happened at a certain place and to certain people. And I want you to guess the motive. The certain place was a public house, and the certain people, two men and a woman.
Look, Bill, here's Mary Haldane. I haven't been seen in around the old haunts lately.
Certain it is that I've never set my eyes on her at this time of day. She usually is sleeping during the light hours.
I'm thinking she looks none too happy. What do you think of her for,
She'd be the right type. I don't think she'd be missed. Let's try her out.
Ah, well now, Mary McGill, you're out very early today, are you not?
Early, late, makes no difference when you're only half alive.
Closing time, gentlemen.
Come to think of it, Mary, you're looking a bit under the weather now. You've not been drinking, have you?
That's just it. This is my first and it looks like being the last. I'm sober as a saint and very, very sorry for it.
What in the name of heaven will it be then that's making you so unhappy?
Money, Bill. Money. Haven't any.
Ah, well, now, I'm thinking a wee dram of the finest refreshment in the world. It would be doing you no harm at all, Mary, now. Come along with us to Bill's house. We were just going to have a drop ourselves, now.
Oh, thank you, gentlemen, thank you. I'm just dying for a drink. You never know how much you love the stuff until you haven't got the money to buy it. Oh, thank you, gentlemen. You've probably saved my life.
Gentlemen, never had such a great time. Oh, no.
shouldn't have any more, do you think? He gave me so much already. Oh, well then, just one more. Oh, that's good. The taste seems to get better and better and better.
Come along now, Mary. Just one more now. This one will taste better than all the others put together.
Oh, no, really? Oh, well, I'm finding myself getting a bit dizzy, you know. I don't think I better have any more.
Really, Sozzle, now's the time. Get that pillow quick.
What was that? Is that Bruce?
Drink, Mary. Just a little drink, you know. Just another little drop of the pretty shine in your lovely eyes now.
Oh, Bill. You and your compliment. You'll be the death of me.
Quick now. Over her mouth and nose. I got a light. It won't be long now.
I think it's all over now. Can you hear her heart?
Just a second.
Yes, it's still beating. It's fainter. I can hardly hear it now. Yes, it stopped.
And now, what was the motive for that murder? A murder deliberately planned and executed. What was the motive? The woman had no money. She'd done nothing to call for revenge. The murderers certainly neither loved nor hated her. What could they gain from her death? What did they want from her? Well, they wanted her dead body.
If you have high blood pressure, here are good reasons to stay on your medication.
There are people around who need you so. They shower you with love just to let you know. They want you to be there to see their dreams come true. But you won't be there if you don't take care of you.
Do it for them.
Your son and your daughter.
Blood pressure lead to a stroke, kidney, or heart failure. Treat it and live. Stay on your daily medication, if not for yourself, for them.
Do it for all the loved ones in your life.
A public service of this station and the Advertising Council.
We open our story in November 1827 in Edinburgh, Scotland. There, in a filthy retreat called Tanner's Close, situated in the lowest quarter of the city, there existed a tramp's lodging house. The terms were not exorbitant, threepence per person per night. But the fact that the hovel only contained 8 beds did not mean that only 8 lodgers were accommodated. They usually slept 2 or 3 in a bed. The landlord was an Irishman, William Hare. In the house as a paying guest was another Irishman, William Burke, with his girlfriend, Helen MacDougall. As Burke and Hare were friendly, so did friendship spring up between Mrs. Hare and Miss MacDougall. Now for the story. On this particular evening, Hare came into Burke's room in an obviously angry mood.
Hello there.
Evening to you, Hare. And what is it I can be doing for you?
Oh, I was just dropping in for a spot of talk and perhaps a spot of spirit.
Yes. I was just having a dram myself. There's nothing to touch it.
That's true enough. One could buy a lot of whiskey with £4 now, couldn't one?
And why £4? Now then, come on with you. What is it you'll be having on your mind?
Well, it's this way, Burke. That old man Donald.
There, my pensioner upstairs, who's always having them nightmares.
He'll be having no more nightmares. He's dead.
Is he, by the saint? And when?
Yesterday morning.
Well, now. But what's there in an old man dying off to worry you? He had to die sometime. You didn't have a hand in it yourself now, did you?
Lord, no. He died of too much drinking and old age. I wanted him to stay alive, the old codger. He owed me money.
That'll be the £4 you mentioned.
Yes, and he's left nothing. Not a farthing.
That's bad. Bad indeed now. I'm terribly sorry, Hare.
Burke, I've been thinking now. There might be a way of, so to speak, retrieving the money.
A relation?
No, he had none to my knowledge. Would you be knowing of a Dr. Monroe? He's a lecturer at the medical school.
I've heard his name somewhere now.
He lectures to the students on anatomy or some such name, and he shows them what he's driving at in his talk by pointing it out on a body. A dead body. He cuts up the body while he's talking to them.
Ah, go on, Hare, now. But what's this got to do with old Donald upstairs?
Dr. Monroe is short of bodies right now. He pays well for them, and no questions asked. He usually gets them from the students who rob the graves of the dead up at the church.
But you'd be wanting to sell him old Donald without having to put the corpse in the grave at all.
Right. Will you be helping me? I need help in this.
What'll I be getting out of it?
Anything over the £4 that Donald owes me.
I'm with you, then. Where's the body?
In the coffin in the yard. We'll stuff the box with a bag of wood, then nail the lid back on. No one will know it isn't a corpse inside when they come to bury it.
Let's get on with it, then.
The idea was a variation on the old one of body snatching. The robbing of graves had been going on since early in the previous century. The dissecting tables of the medical schools were kept supplied mainly by bands of such thieves who would rob the nearby churchyards at a good profit. If you've ever been to Edinburgh, you will perhaps have noticed the cage-like effect of certain cemeteries, the graves being fenced in with iron bars. These are relics of an age when the sleep and peace of the dead were liable to be disturbed by the resurrectionists, as they were called. Sometimes the robbers would keep a watch over the aged and ailing members of the community waiting for death to do its work. And then, almost before the body was stiff in its grave, they would dig it up and take it to the nearest market. In other words, the nearest medical school. It was illegal, of course, and the strict Scots religion made the crime very unpopular. But all this tended to make the price of bodies higher, and though the risks were great, so were the profits.
And this must be the door, number 10. That's right. Well, there's someone about, anyway. Should we bargain, do you think?
Better not the first time. Let's hear what they have to offer. If he pays enough to cover Donald's debts to you and a bit more for me, I'll be content.
And I wish he'd hurry up. I don't like carrying a corpse all over Edinburgh with me.
Shh. Can I help you, gentlemen?
We've come to see Dr. Knox.
Well, I'm afraid he's busy at the moment. Can I help you? No, you can trust me.
Well, now, we have this...
Oh, I see. I'm sorry. Come inside. Put it down on this table. That's right. Now then, take it out of the sack. Now, I'm afraid I can't offer you more than £7.
£7, is it?
Oh, all right then, £7.10, but no more. Now, here you are.
Thank you kindly, sir.
In a moment, we'll return to the secrets of Scotland Yard with your host, Clive Brooke.
These days, we're hearing a lot about productivity. And it's easy to see why. Because if our country can manage to make a little more out of our natural, financial, and human resources, we can slow down inflation, strengthen our economy, and make our jobs more secure. Sounds like a politician's dream, doesn't it? Well, it's more practical than you might think. Because what it takes is not muscle, but ideas. Ideas on how to do a job a little better. Ideas on how to make a piece of steel go a little further. Ideas on how to make crops grow a little better. And America is strong on ideas. So if you can use your ingenuity to do your job a little more productively, do it. And encourage others to do the same. America has always worked best when we all work together. This message from the National Center for Productivity and Quality of Working Life, brought to you by the Ad Council and this station.
Among the lodgers at the establishment of William Hare was a miller named Joseph.
How's that fellow Joseph getting on? He was coughing all last night. I couldn't sleep a wink on his account now.
Ah, he's worse. And his fever's alarming the other lodgers. Bad for business, you know. Some of them will be leaving unless he gets better soon.
Better or worse? Much worse.
Eh?
Let's go and see him. We might be able to put the poor devil out of his suffering. And Hare, I'm thinking Dr. Knox might be getting a wee bit anxious about bodies for his lectures. Are you with me?
Yes. Joseph would be better off dead anyway.
Oh.
Has he any relations that might be worried about him?
Not that I know of. Here's the door.
Now, wait till I say the word, and then move quickly. We don't want him making an unholy row.
Hold on. Half shares when we sell the body.
Of course, man. What did you think?
Come in. Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening to you, Joseph. And how are you feeling tonight?
Oh, Mr. Burke, I haven't long for this world, I fear. Not long.
Now, what do you think, Hare?
Not long, I fear.
Quick now, put the pillow over his mouth. I'll hold his legs.
Don't.
I've got
don't.
Him. That's done. Now, this time we have...
In Burke's later confession to an Edinburgh evening paper, he winds up this particular episode with the words, "Sold to Dr. Knox for £10. About 9 months after the first murder, that of Joseph the Miller, an ex-soldier and his wife, Mr. and Mrs. Gray, were staying at the lodging house. One evening, there was a party given by Burke in his room to which all the lodgers were invited. Burke gave the party in honor of a little old woman he had found in a wine shop. Mr. and Mrs. Gray were among the guests.
Would you believe it now? There I am having my morning dram of whiskey in old Rymer's shop, when what should I be hearing but a gentle voice speaking in accents of my own beloved Ireland, asking for arms she was. Now, Mrs. Gray, would I be the true son of the fairest land in all the world if I were not asking you to take a little refreshment at my expense? And as sure as my name's William Burke, what would you think I would be finding her name was?
I'm sure I don't know, Mr. Burke. I'm sure I don't know.
Why, Doherty. Doherty. The same as my darling mother's name. God rest her soul. And would it be right now? I'm asking you, Mrs. Gray, if I were not to be throwing a bit of a party tonight for the sake of a dear relation of mine.
Very kind of you, Mr. Burke. But you know, thinking your dear relation is a wee drop too much of the whiskey. She's old now and none too steady in her feet.
Oh, Billy Hare will be taking care of her. He's dancing with her now. Oh, look now, if he hasn't trampled on her feet.
Oh, she doesn't look too badly hurt to me.
No, probably just a sprain. Now, are you all right, my dear Maggie?
Oh, Mr. Burke, I'm not hurt bad, but I'm afraid there'll be no more dancing for me tonight.
Nor any other night. The party continued drunken and noisy into the small hours. Mr. and Mrs. Gray left comparatively early, but returned on Hare's invitation to breakfast the next morning.
What became of the old lady you had with you last night?
Doherty, do you mean? The old hag. Did you not hear the row in here all night? She got so drunk she thought she was 50 years younger and started getting much too friendly with me. We kicked the silly old baggage out of the house.
Well, is that so, Buck?
That's the truth I'm telling you, Mrs. Gray. I put up with the old girl as long as I could, but we had to get rid of her in the end. Oh, what a row she made. But she's quiet enough now, Mrs. Gray. Mm. Keep away from that bed, if you please, now.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Burke. I wanted to get to the potatoes. They're under here, aren't they?
What in the name of mercy are you doing near the bed with the lighted pipe in your mouth now? Come away, do you hear?
What's my pipe got to do with it?
Wait, woman, you might set the straw on fire with it, and then there'd be a nice mess now. I'll get the potatoes myself, and I'll warn everybody to keep away from this part of the room.
This peculiar conduct naturally aroused the curiosity of the Greys, but it was not until nearly evening that Burke left the house, by which time Mrs. Gray must have smoked several more pipes. As soon as Burke left, she went straight to the bed, lifted the cover, and there she discovered the dead body of Mrs. Doherty. It is due to the unswerving honesty of Mrs. Gray and her husband that the criminals were brought to justice. Both Burke and his mistress tried to bribe them to keep quiet about their discovery. They were poor people, and the offer of £10 a week must have been very tempting, but they went to the police. And gradually the whole horrible story came out. Though it was not until much later, when Burke made his confession, that the public learned the full extent of the crime that had been committed in Tanner's Close. For the moment, only the murder of Mrs. Doherty was before them. But was it murder? The first job of the public prosecutor was to prove this, to establish what in Scots law is called the corpus delicti. But owing to the subtlety of the murderer's methods, the surgeon of the Edinburgh City Police was unable to say whether the old woman has really died from violence. The evidence against all four concerned was inadequate, and at one time it looked as though it would be a case of having no trial. But finally, as all four still denied all accusations against them, it was decided that Hare should be asked to turn King's evidence. Hare readily accepted the offer, He came into the court with a ghastly smile.
William Hare, we observe that you are at present a prisoner in the toll booth of Edinburgh. And from what we know, the court understands that you must have had some concern in the transaction now under investigation. It is therefore my duty to inform you that whatever share you might have had in that transaction, if you now speak the truth, you can never afterwards be questioned in the court of justice.
These words must have reassured him greatly. He implicated himself and his partner Burke with every word he spoke, knowing all the time that only Burke would pay the penalty. The case started at 10 a.m. on December the 24th, 1828, and the court sat without a break until 9:30 the next morning, Christmas Day, when the verdict was returned. Burke's mistress, MacDougall, was acquitted, as the charge against her was not proven, which is a Scots compromise between guilt and innocence. Hare's wife went free, as his evidence could not concern her. Wife cannot bear witness against husband. That William Hare himself went free seems unjust to us now, but at the time it was a case of one or neither, and the course taken was the only possible one within the law. I would like you all to hear the sentence passed on Burke. It was the normal one for murderers in Scotland, but it has, I think, a special significance when applied to a man who made his living by the sale of corpses to the medical school.
And upon that day, to be taken forth from the said toll booth to the common place of execution in the Lawn Market of Edinburgh, and then and there to be hanged by the neck by the hands of the common executioner upon a gibbet until he be dead, and his body thereafter to be delivered to Dr. Alexander Munro, Professor of Anatomy in the University of Edinburgh, to be by him publicly dissected and anatomized. And may God Almighty have mercy on your soul.
And so it was that William Burke ended up in the same way as the numerous men and women that he and his fiendish partner had smothered to death on a lecturer's dissecting table.
No face is lovelier than the face that emerges from a pink ice. Hot and cold money. The money it costs all of us to keep our homes cool in summer and warm in winter. To save some money and help conserve our precious energy resources, here's some good advice. The amount of energy necessary to heat or cool your home is greatly affected by your insulation. Good insulation keeps furnace heat inside in winter and the sun outside in summer. If it's faced with foil, it'll serve as a barrier against moisture vapor. Aluminum-faced insulation aids in retarding heat flow, and proper insulation can make large savings in money and energy. A properly insulated roof can save 90% of heat loss compared to an uninsulated roof. Good insulation can save a considerable amount of heat loss through walls and floors, not to mention the benefits of insulated aluminum siding. In hot weather or cold, a properly insulated house will be comfortable and economical. Mutual Broadcasting System has presented The Secrets of Scotland Yard with your host and narrator, Clive Brooke. In cooperation with the Kraft Foods Company, makers of... This is Sanford Marshall inviting you to return next week when we will again reveal The Secrets of Scotland Yard.
Michael Jaston stars as the grim and chilling James Bond in his only outing with directions by Michael Bakewell and an ensemble cast. James Bond's wife, Tracy, has been murdered by his deadly enemy Blofeld. Agent 007 has gone completely to pieces and is drafting his resignation. But M is prepared to give him one last chance to prove himself, on a mission which will lead him to a fatal encounter in a Japanese garden of death. From 1990 on BBC 4, here is from the Ian Fleming's James Bond series, You Only Live Twice.
Fleming's classic story, You Only Live Twice, and it takes us back to the beginning when James Bond's wife was murdered. He's gutted and is drafting his resignation, but M wants to give him one last chance to prove himself.
Will you mind being looked after, Tracy?
That's what it means, being Mr. and Mrs., doesn't it? They don't say Mrs. and Mr. But you need looking after too, James. Let's just look after each other.
There's a red car coming up fast behind.
Do you want me to lose him?
No, let him go. We've got all the time in the world. Tracy! Tracy!
You Only Live Twice by Ian Fleming. Dramatized for radio by Michael Bacroft. With Michael Jaston as James Bond and Clive Merrison as Tanaka.
It's 007. He's going slowly to pieces. He's drinking too much and losing a lot of money at one of these new gambling clubs. He's on the verge of becoming a pretty serious security risk.
What do you expect? Confirmed womanizer suddenly falls in love. Partly, I suspect, because the woman was a bird with a wing down and needed his help. So he marries her, and within a few hours, she's shot dead by some master criminal in a mad act of vengeance. What did you say his name was?
Blofeld. Ernst Stavro Blofeld.
When Bond came to see me, he told me he wasn't interested in anything anymore. Not his job, not even his life. He blames himself for her death. Neither you nor I have ever had to carry a burden like that. At least I haven't.
Nor I. Well, not like that, anyway.
So we don't know how we'd react under it. Have you tried him on any really tough assignments in the last few months?
Two. He bungled them both. On one, he nearly got himself killed. And on the other, he made a mistake that nearly killed everybody else. He never made mistakes before. Now, suddenly, he's become accident-prone.
Well, why did you ask to see me?
To confirm my own worst fears. You'll have to go. Honorable discharge.
Well, isn't that a bit harsh?
I've got no room in my section for a lame brain, whatever his past record. Or whatever excuses you psychologists can find for him. Pension, of course. Try to find him a job. One of the top security organizations might take him on.
You've been losing one of your best men.
Used to be. Isn't any longer.
I still can't help feeling that if he were placed in a really desperate situation, he might get himself back on the rails. Give him one more chance. If it'll help, I'll take the responsibility.
What sort of chance?
I don't know much about your line of business, but haven't you got something really sticky, some apparently hopeless assignment you can give him, but something that's desperately important at the same time, something that really matters to his country? Can't you dream up a mission that would put to the test everything that's in him?
Can I refill your glass, sir?
You certainly can.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Blonde hair that falls across her face. A beautifully poised walk. A very presentable bottom. A year ago, I'd have been after her like a shot. And now, I just can't feel a thing. But then I can't feel anything about anything. The zip's gone out of life. No excitement, no desires. Perhaps I'm suffering from an adrenaline deficiency. You're washed up, James. And that must be Mary Goodnight calling me home across the sands of Dee. Just time to finish the bottle, I think.
Oh, for God's sake, James, where have you been? Em sent for you nearly an hour ago.
Sitting in the cafe at Queen Mary's Rose Garden.
What a peculiar place to choose.
I went to look at the roses. Thinking about my retirement.
M wants you. He rang again half an hour ago.
Who's M?
Oh, snap out of it, James. Your tie's crooked. And your hair's all over the place. Here, use my comb.
Thanks. You're a good girl, Goodnight. Must look my best on the scaffold. Will you come and lend a hand on my chicken farm?
You've been taking your time.
Afternoon, Miss Moneypenny.
He's waiting for you. Go straight in.
Good afternoon, sir.
Sit down, James. You know why I've sent for you.
I can guess. You can have my resignation.
What the hell are you talking about? It's not your fault that the 007 section's been idle for so long. Anyway, I'm taking you out of there.
Then if it's all the same with you, sir, I'd still like to put in my resignation. I'm not interested in staff work, I'm afraid, sir.
Who the hell do you think you're talking to? Who the devil do you think is running this show?
I'm terribly sorry, sir. I thought I'd been letting the side down lately.
Now listen to me, James. I'm giving you acting promotion to the diplomatic section. Four-figure number and $1,000 a year extra pay. I'll be leaving for Japan inside a week. The chief of staff is handling all the arrangements personally. It's top secret.
I see, sir.
There's not even a file on the case. That's how important it is.
I thought you'd called me in to give me the job. Why choose me?
For the simple reason that the job's impossible. Perhaps that's going a bit too far. Let's say totally improbable of success.
Improbable?
You're no stranger to situations like that. The only difference here is that there won't be any strong-arm stuff, none of the gunplay you pride yourself on so much. It'll just be a question of your wits and nothing else.
Can you fill me in any more detail?
Have to, as there's nothing written down. Do you know anything about cryptography?
Only the bare bones. It's a subject I've preferred to keep clear of. Better that way, in case the opposition never got hold of me.
Quite right. The point is that the Japanese have become past masters at it. They've got the right mentality for finicky problems in letters and numbers. They can crack anything. And for the last year, they've been reaching the cream of the Soviet traffic from Vladivostok and Oriental Russia. Diplomatic, naval, air force, the lot.
So what's the problem?
The problem is none of it's coming our way. It's all going straight to the CIA.
And they're not passing it on to us?
Not where the Pacific is concerned. They regard that as their private preserve. They're worried about our security. Can't blame them. I'm equally worried about theirs.
But where do I come in on all this, sir?
There's a man in Tokyo called Tanaka. Tiger Tanaka, head of their secret service. I can't remember what they call it, some unpronounceable Japanese rubbish. He's quite a man. First at Oxford, a formidable mind, and a highly trained war machine to the bargain. He's the chap who has control of the stuff we want. You've got to go out there and get it off him.
But how on earth am I going to do that?
That's your problem. So you do see why you're unlikely to succeed. He's in fief to the CIA. He probably doesn't think much of us. People don't these days.
Is there anyone out there who can brief me?
We don't have a station in Japan at present. You'll be working with the Australians. I'm told they've got a good man in Tokyo. Section J says so too. Anyway, that's how it is. If anyone can bring it off, you can. Care to have a go, James?
Yes, sir. I'd like to have a try.
Good. You'll be meeting up with an Australian chap called Richard Lovelace Henderson, generally known as Dicko. He'll give you a basic briefing on what Japan's all about. It's not all cherry blossom, by any means.
Hello, sir. Welcome to Tokyo. Are you for the International Laundry Convention?
No.
Sorry you've been troubled. Have a nice day.
Excuse me, sir. Are you here for the food processing?
No.
Excuse me, are you Mr. Fleming?
No, I'm not.
Oh, pardon me, I'm sure. I'm looking for a Mr. Fleming.
God, what a place. Why do they have to make such a bloody noise about everything? If this is the mysterious East, give me Sochiol Street on a wet Saturday. But I think rescue is at hand. The character who's bulging out of his shirt and sweating like a pig could very well be Dicko Henderson.
Mr. Bond. Oh, good to meet you. My name's Henderson.
Heaven be praised. How did you know who I was?
You're the only pommy on the plane.
Is it always like this? It's taken me the best part of an hour to get one sodding suitcase through customs. What a goddamn place.
Ah, that's my boy. That's the way to greet the East. I got a car outside. Sooner we get out of this adjectival madhouse, the better.
I'm taking you to your hotel first, the Okura. It's the latest of the Western ones. American tourists got murdered in the Royal Oriental the other day. We don't want to lose you all that soon.
Doesn't look like the most attractive city in the world.
Why are we driving on the left?
Oh, God knows. Bloody Japs do everything wrong. We've probably read the instruction books wrong. The light switches go up instead of down. The taps turn to the left. They even race their horses clockwise instead of anti-clockwise like civilized people. It's got its points when you know your way around. It's really quite exhilarating. Got to know the lingo, though, when to bow and take your shoes off and so on. Underneath the stiff collars and the striped pants, there's still plenty of the old samurai tucked away.
Don't think I'm paranoid or anything, but that blue car's been on our tail ever since we left the airport.
Don't let it worry you. It's only old Tiger keeping tabs on us. It's typical. I told him you were staying at the Okura, but he wants to make sure for himself. If you find one of his men breathing down your neck in bed tonight, or a girl if you're lucky, just talk to them politely and they'll bow and hiss themselves out.
Thanks for the tip.
Yeah, I'll drop you off at the hotel, then we can go and get down to some serious drinking. The little place called Melody's, where we're bound to find a quiet corner where we can't be overheard. I've fixed up for you to meet Tiger tomorrow morning at 11. I'll pick you up and take you there. The Bureau of All Asia Folkways. I won't describe it to you, it'd spoil it. Hey, Chrysanthemum, can you turn that down? I can't hear myself drink. Now, I don't really know what you're here for. There's a spate of top-secret cables from Melbourne. The ambassador doesn't want to know anything about it, and I don't want to know anything either. That way, you're the only one who gets powdered bamboo in his coffee. You shove that bottle over, will you? Oh, just a minute. Oh, the damnation, sis. The bastard, the bloody bastard.
Take it easy, Dicko. What's bitten you?
You stupid pommy idiot. We've been mic'd. The bludger Tanaka's mic'd us. Here, under the table. See that little wire down the leg? And you see that wingy over at the bar? That's one of Tiger's men. He dresses them all like little CIA gentlemen. Damn good mind to go over and call the bastard.
Well, if we're being mic'd, all this will make sweet listening for Tanaka tomorrow.
Oh, what the hell? The old bastard knows what I think of him. It's really you he wants to size up, and I don't mind if he hears me saying so. Do you hear that, Tiger? Bludger! That's a great Australian insult. You can use it any way you like, but in general it means pervert, ponce, liar and traitor with no redeeming feature. Yeah, I hope your seaweed sticks in your gullet at breakfast tomorrow when you hear what I think of you. All right, we'll put an end to this little game. Silly bastard. You ought to know we're not proposing to assassinate the Emperor. Hey, Lotus Blossom, bring us another flask of sake.
Okay.
I gather you want to get some high-powered gen out of Tiger without the CIA knowing anything about it, right? Well, it's going to be a dicey business. Tiger's a career man with a career mind, though on the surface he's 100% Demokarazu. He is a deep one. He's very deep and deep.
Sake, Henderson-san.
Thanks, honey.
And what sort of a chap is he? Is he your enemy or your friend?
Oh, both. More of a friend, probably. At least I guess so. I amuse him. His CIA pals don't. He looses up with me. We share in the delights of samsara, that's wine and women. Great man for the little ladies. I managed to keep him out of two marriages. That's the trouble with Tiger. He always wants to marry them. He's paying alimony to three already, so he has acquired an on with regard to me as an obligation, almost as important in the Japanese way of life as face. When you have an on, you're not happy till you've discharged it. And if a man makes you a present of a salmon, you mustn't repay him with a shrimp. Got to be an equally large salmon, larger if possible. Well, Tiger's on toward me is a very powerful one, very difficult to discharge. He's paying off a slice of it by accepting your presence here and giving you an interview so soon after your arrival. Could have taken you weeks. Is it my imagination, or are these bottles getting smaller?
It's all in the mind, Dicko.
What you got to get into your head is that the Japanese are a separate human species. They've only been operating as a civilized people in the debased way we talk about in the West for 50, at the most 100 years. Just because people play baseball and wear bowler hats doesn't mean they're, quote, civilized, unquote. And just to show you, I'm getting rather tight. Not drunk, mind. The world is going to reap the father and mother of a whirlwind by the, quote, liberation, unquote, of the colonial peoples. Give them 1,000 years, they might make it, but give them 10, there's no chance. You're only taking away their blowpipes and giving them machine guns. Just you wait for the first one to start crying to high heaven for nuclear fission.
That doesn't sound exactly Demokarazu, Dicko.
I fornicate, as the man said, upon thy Demokarazu. Hey, Madam Butterfly, let's have another flask of sake, and you make sure it's a full one this time.
Dicko, don't you think that maybe...
Listen here, you pommy poofter. Don't give me any of that liberal crap.
For God's sake, Dicko, let's go and get some food. What's all this pommy poofter rubbish?
I'll reserve judgment till later. We'll go and eat at a place where we can get a few serious bottles of plonk to match, and then we'll go on to the House of Total Delight, and after that, I'll give you my honest verdict, honestly come by. I wouldn't like Tiger to think I was saddling him with a poofter.
Aren't we a bit early?
Oh, better to give ourselves a bit of time. Tiger doesn't like to be kept waiting. Oh, boy, did I lay one on last night.
You were going at a bit.
Did I talk a lot of crap, or did you seem to recollect one of us did?
You kept on calling me a pommy poofter. You were quite friendly about it. No offence given or taken.
Out you get. This is it.
The Bureau of All Asian Folkways.
Okay, you can keep the change.
Looks like some kind of museum. You mean this is Tanaka's HQ?
As the man said, you ain't seen nothing yet. Just follow me. That door over there. Coordination department.
Nobody seems very concerned about us. What do they do in all these little offices?
Coordinate, I guess. Through here. International relations.
I see what you mean.
Visual presentation. Documentation.
Good morning, Mr. Henderson.
Morning. This is where the cover tapers off. Up till now, all those people really were researching Asian folkways. This way. But these here are part of Tiger's outside staff. This is where we'd be politely turned back if we'd lost our way. Now, this is us. Proposed extension to documentation department.
But where's the construction work?
There isn't any. It's just a front. What you heard was the tape recording. Now, take a look at this. It's what they call a nightingale floor. Relic of the old days when people wanted to be warned of intruders. Take a step forward. See what I mean?
I can't imagine anyone getting across this unheard.
You notice a little spy hole that's flown open on the door opposite?
Ah, good morning, Mr. Henderson.
I brought this gentleman to see Tanaka-san.
He is expected.
You're on your own now, sport. Tiger will send you back to your hotel. See ya.
Tell Mother I died game.
Through there, sir.
Doesn't seem to be an exit. It's a lift. Quite a box of tricks Tiger's worked out for himself. The oriental nest of boxes. What next? It's an underground station, but not a sign of life anywhere. A sinister-looking little chap, beckoning.
This way, Commander.
It doesn't seem I've got much choice but to follow. Prefabricated offices. Is there no end to all this?
You are sent by Mr. Henderson. Please to come this way. Commander Bond.
My dear Commander, good morning. It is a great pleasure to meet you. Come and sit down.
Thank you.
How do you like my offices? Rather different from your own chief's, no doubt. But the new underground will take another 10 years to complete, and there is little office space in Tokyo. It crossed my mind to make use of this disused station. It is quiet, it is private, and it costs us next to nothing. Down here, we have to count our pennies. I suppose it is the same with you,
Under 10 million a year doesn't go far when there's the whole world to cover.
At least in the last 10 years, you have saved money by cutting down your activities in this part of the world.
Yes. We rely on the CIA to do our work here for us. They're most efficient and helpful.
Are they as helpful as they were under the previous regime?
Nowadays, they're rather more inclined to regard the Pacific as their own back garden.
From which you want to borrow the mowing machine without them knowing.
The manufacturer's trademark for this particular machine is Magic 44.
That is the name you have given to our cipher-breaking organization.
Our code name, yes.
Yes. A most valuable implement of many uses. I can understand that your country would wish to have the services of this implement. A case in point is an example of its capabilities which came into my hands this morning. May I beg you on oath not to reveal to anyone what you are about to read.
If you insist, Mr. Tanaka.
I am afraid I must, Commander.
So be it. To all stations of grade 2 and above to be deciphered by addressees personally and then destroyed. Text begins. In amplification of number 1 speech to the Supreme Soviet, this confirms possession of the 200 megaton weapon and that a test firing will take place on September the 20th at high altitude in the Novaya Zemlya area. Stop. For information, the delivery of one such weapon by ICM beyond London would destroy all life and property south of a line drawn between Newcastle and Carlisle. This fact will shortly be employed as the teeth in a diplomatic démarche designed to achieve the removal of all American bases in Britain itself. Stop. Surely it's a mistake to keep this material from us. We have a treaty of friendship and a trade treaty with you. Do you not regard the withholding of this vital information as a dishonorable act?
Honor is a very serious word in Japan, Commander. Well, would it not be more dishonorable to break our word to our good American friends, There is, of course, in this instance, an alternative route for this information to reach your government.
But you put me on my oath.
Commander, I was very happy in England before the war. Your people were very good to me. I repaid them in an unworthy fashion. I plead youth and the heat of a war that I thought would bring great glory to my country. I was mistaken. We were defeated. The expiation of that dishonor is a large matter, a matter for the youth of this country. But I have my own private accounts to balance. I am in great debt to your country. This morning I have betrayed a state secret to you. I fully realize the importance of this piece of paper to Britain. You remember the contents?
Exactly, I think.
And you are on your honor not to communicate it elsewhere.
Yes. And that's all.
For the time being, I need time to think things over. Honor is a pattern of behavior, Commander. The bamboo must bend to the breeze, but equally, the cedar must bend to the typhoon. The meaning of this is simply that sometimes duty is more compelling than any words. Call on me again tomorrow.
Oh, well, that's fantastic. You obviously hit it off with him, champ.
He thinks the world of you, too. But do you think he's on the level? It seems too easy.
A tiger would consider it dishonorable to lead you up the garden path and then pull the rug out from under you. Something's definitely cooking in the background.
He can't be doing this simply out of a sense of honor.
You don't understand the Japanese mentality. This on he's got in respect of Britain is a huge factor in your favor. If you get any more gifts like the last one, you'll be piling up a great heap of on in respect of Tiger. And if it comes to striking a bargain, I hope you've got a pretty massive present up your sleeve so that the on both sides is more or less equally balanced. None of this salmon and shrimp business. Have got? Can do?
I'm not so sure.
I have given you a new name. Commander James Bond is perhaps a little too formal, I shall call you Bondo-san, Is that acceptable?
Perfectly. And what do I call you?
You call me Tiger.
And may I ask how you acquired that name?
I was born in the year of the Tiger.
Oh. And you happen to know what year I was born in?
Yes, I do, Bondo-san. You were born in the year of the Rat. As a fair trader, has your country got to offer in exchange for the full use of magic fofo?
We have a most important intelligence network in China known as the Macau Blue Route. The fruits of this source would be placed entirely at your disposal.
I'm very much afraid that I have bad news for you, Bondo-san. Blue Route has been penetrated by my organization almost since its inception. What other goods had you in mind for our exchange?
We have many other commodities. But, my dear Tiger, would it not be a good idea, once your mind is made up, for you to pay a visit to London and inspect the shelves for yourself? I'm sure my chief would be honored to receive you.
You do not possess full powers of negotiation?
No, that would be impossible. Our security is such that even I have not full knowledge of all our merchandise.
I'm only in a position to pass on to my chief the substance of what you say, or to render any other personal services you might ask of me.
Personal services? Ah, that is a possibility. I must get to know you, Bondo-san. Permit me to invite you to a geisha party at the House of Grey Pearl tomorrow evening.
Oh, boy, you're really into it now. It's a great honor.
A party in a geisha house?
And it'll cost Tiger a small fortune. You better put a good face on the whole thing. This could be the breakthrough you've been waiting for.
But he knows already that I've nothing to offer him.
Well, then it's even more important that you keep your hand up.
But what's so special about a party in a geisha house?
Well, the Orientals see it as a kind of art form, like the tea ceremony or flower arrangement. For a foreigner, it's more like trying to entertain a lot of unknown children to a nursery tea with a very strict governess looking on.
And what do the girls actually do?
Well, the high-class ones can sing and paint and tell humorous stories and compose elaborate verses.
And the ones who aren't high-class? I mean, do they actually...
With a bit of luck? Tiger will probably arrange a pillow geisha for you. But you'll have to sit through a lot of chatter and play games before you get around to the real thing.
Games? What sort of games?
Word games, music games, games of skill like scissor, cut, paper.
Oh, scissors, cut, paper, paper, wrap, stone, stone, blunt, scissors.
That's it.
You make a kind of hammer gesture with your closed fist twice and then show your hand on the third strike.
That's right, and don't forget, the Japanese take their games very seriously indeed.
That's a cheat. You agreed that if I won, it would be a real kiss on the mouth, Trembling Leaf, at the very least.
On the mouth?
On the mouth.
Go ahead, my child.
Ah, Bondo-san, I will not challenge you to this ridiculous game, and I promise you in advance that you will not win.
All right, Tiger. But first, let's have some more sake. And not in these ridiculous thimbles. I've drunk 5 flasks of the stuff, and the effect is about the same as 1 double martini.
He know how to hold his drink, but he won't be much use to Trembling Leaf if he goes on like this.
You have gained much face, Bondo-san. It is only the sumo wrestlers who drink sake in these quantities without showing it. But Great Pearl might be right.
The sake, master.
Thank you, Trembling Leaf.
Drink deep, Bondo-san. And then we will begin.
Your health, Tiger.
If I beat him, he will lose face in front of all these women. If I lose, I shall lose face in front of him. So do I play to win or lose. But it's as difficult to play to lose as to play to win. And does it really matter?
3 games of 3.
Right. Ha! Paper wrapped stone.
Stone, blunt, scissors. I've got you.
Paper wrapped stone. First game to me.
Second game.
Paper.
Again. Stone, blunt, scissors.
Scissors, cut paper. Stone. Again.
Stone, blunt, scissors. My game. 1-1. Last game. Are you ready?
Fire away. Stone, blunt, scissors. Paper, wrap, stone.
I drink to your victory, Bondo-san.
Sake, Bondo-san.
Thank you, Trembling Leaf. Your health, Tiger. Ah. And now, Trembling Leaf, it's time for you to give me another kiss.
On the mouth?
On the mouth.
Bondo-san, I have matters to discuss with you. Will you do me the honor of coming to my house for a nightcap?
Of course, Tiger. Nothing would give me greater pleasure. Good night, Trembling Leaf. Another time, perhaps.
Good night, Bondo-san.
Not too noisy for you, I hope. In a little while, the traffic will die away, and we will be left with the sounds of the harbor, which I find soothing. The sake is warm enough.
Perfect, thank you.
Then listen to what I have to say to you. Ever since the beginning of the westernization of Japan, there have from time to time been foreigners who have come to this country and settled here. They have for the most part been cranks and scholars. But there is one such person who has revealed himself to be an eccentric of the most devilish nature. The man is a monster. Huh? No, you may laugh, but this man is no less than a fiend in human form.
I have met many bad men in my time, Tiger, and generally they've been slightly mad. Is that the case in this instance?
Oh, very much the reverse. In the opinion of our highest scholars and savants, he is a scientific research worker and collector, probably unique in the history of the world.
What does he collect?
He collects death.
A collector of death? You mean he kills people?
No, Bondo-san. It is not as simple as that. He persuades, or rather entices people to kill themselves. I had better begin at the beginning. In January of this year, there entered this country, quite legally, a gentleman by the name of Dr. Guntram Shatterhand. He was accompanied by his wife. They had Swiss passport, and the doctor described himself as a horticulturalist and botanist specializing in subtropical species. He told the authorities he was prepared to spend no less than £1 million on establishing an exotic garden or park in this country, which he would stock with a priceless collection of rare, fully grown plants and shrubs from all over the world.
Quite a proposition.
Well, his offer was enthusiastically accepted by the government, who, in return, granted the good doctor a 10-year residence permit, a very rare privilege. Now, the doctor took a fancy to a half-ruined castle in Kyushu, a southern island in an extremely remote corner of the coast, not far from Fukuoka, a gigantic edifice with a monumental surrounding wall, which was just what was required for the privacy of the undertaking. An additional reason for the doctor's choice of site was that the property was highly volcanic and furnished with many geysers which would provide all the year round the temperature needed for the tropical plants and trees.
And what has your Dr. Shatterhand done with this castle?
He has created what I can only describe as a garden of death.
Garden of death?
Listen, this Dr. Shatterhand has filled this famous park of his uniquely with poison vegetation. The Guyana poison tree, East Indian snakewood, yellow oleander, sandbox tree, every kind of deadly plant known to man. The lakes and streams are stocked with poisonous fish, and the place is infested with snakes, scorpions, and poisonous spiders. He and this wife of his, who is quite hideously ugly, are not harmed by these things because whenever they leave the castle, he wears a suit of armor from the 17th century and she wears some kind of protective clothing.
Dr. Shatterhand's garden sounds indeed a lovesome thing, God wot. What's the nature of the good doctor's exercise?
Along with our national concept of honor goes a tradition of expiation by death. If a student fails an exam, he has brought dishonor on his ancestors. He kills himself, and the same applies throughout our society. 25,000 Japanese commit suicide every year.
But I still don't see what all this has got to do with friend Shatterhand and his magic garden.
Oh, everything. The garden has become the most desirable site for suicides in the whole of Japan. It has everything. A ride on our famous romance express to Kyoto, a boat trip across our beautiful inland sea, and when you get to Fukuoka, you walk to the awe-inspiring battlements of this mysterious castle of death. Climb them, or smuggle yourself in on a provision car, and then a last delicious ruminative walk, perhaps hand in hand with your lover through the beautiful groves, and finally, the great gamble. Will your death be easy or painful? Will a Russell's viper strike at your legs as you walk the silent, well-raked paths? Will some kindly, deadly dew fall upon you during the night as you rest under this or that gorgeous tree?
But what does your good doctor say to all this?
He tells everyone that he is horrified. He has erected stern notices of warning with skulls and crossbones on them. They act only as advertisements. He has even gone to the expense of flying a high helium balloon from the roof of his castle. The hanging streamers threaten trespassers with prosecution, but alas, for the doctor's precautions, the balloon serves only to beckon, "Here is death. Come and get it."
So, why don't you arrest him? Burn the place down.
Arrest him for what? The man has done nothing wrong. If anyone is to blame, it is the Japanese. And inevitably, more and more people will be attracted to the castle of death. We have got to put a stop to it.
What have you done so far?
Oh, 1 month ago, I sent one of my best men into this place to find out what was going on. 1 week later, Bondo-san, this man was recovered from the sea near the castle of death. He was blinded and in delirium. All the lower half of his body was terribly burnt.
Sounds like a horrible dream. So what did you do?
Oh, what was there to do? I did nothing except apologize to my superiors. I waited for an honorable solution to present itself. I waited for you to come.
Me?
You were sent. It might have been another.
Tiger, it's getting late. Time for bed. Let's talk about this tomorrow. Of course, I'll give you any advice I can.
Sit down, Bondo-san. You will not be going back to your hotel. From now on, you are under my personal orders. Is that understood?
What in God's name are you talking about, Tiger?
In my office the other day, you made a significant statement. You said words to the effect that in exchange for the intelligence obtained by our cipher-breaking service, you were empowered to carry out any personal services that I might require of you.
I didn't say I was empowered. I meant that I would do anything for you on my personal responsibility.
That is quite good enough. I took you at your word, and I requested an audience of the Prime Minister. He instructed me to proceed, but to regard the matter as a state secret known only to himself and me and, of course, to you.
Now, come on, Tiger. Stop beating about the bush. What is it you want me to do?
You are to enter the castle of death and slay the dragon within.
The Saki's got to your head. Why should I be the one to get rid of him?
But for reasons that must be obvious even to you, his assassination cannot be carried out by a Japanese.
But I've got nothing against the man.
That is of no importance. He has already killed 500 of his fellow creatures. And in any case, Bondo-san, you will do this in exchange for magic fofo.
But I bespotted long before I got anywhere near him. Can you think of anyone who looks less like a Japanese than I do?
Oh, by the time we have finished with you, Bondo-san, you will be able to fool even me. Eh? We have talked enough. The first step in your transformation will be accomplished in the bathhouse.
Excuse, please.
Just what do you think you're doing?
Taking off your trousers.
Well, what happens then?
You will lie in a box over a charcoal fire. Then I shall clean your body very carefully.
Uh-huh.
Then I shall administer a black dye to your hair and give you a haircut in the Japanese style.
And after that?
I shall give you a massage.
Mm.
And I shall apply a dark dye all over your body.
And after that?
You will sleep, and I shall wake you with breakfast.
Mm.
Ham and eggs. Then I shall dress you as a Japanese gentleman.
Ah, not bad. Not bad at all. Ah, she has done her work well. Your eyebrows are quite convincing.
I don't care for the trousers much.
Huh? Oh, they're a little loose in the fork, but the behinds of my countrymen are inclined to hang low.
So, what's the next step?
We will take the express to Kamagori on the south coast and the evening hydrofoil across Ise Bay to the fishing port of Toba. There we will spend the night.
Aren't we taking our time, rather?
It'll be a slow journey to Fukuoka, because I want to educate you in Japanese customs so that you will make as few mistakes as possible when the time comes. The train leaves at midday.
The Kamagori Express is ready to leave. Please close all doors and stand clear, please.
Lesson number one, Bondo-san. Never make way for women. Trample them underfoot if necessary. Women have no priority in this country.
Yes, master.
And do not make Western-style jokes when you are my pupil. Huh? Now, let us go and get something to eat and drink in the buffet car. All that sun pouring you forced on me last night is crying out for the skin of the dog that bit me.
The hare, Tiger.
One hare would not be enough. I need the whole skin.
Somebody snitched my wallet. Must have been in the buffet car.
That's not possible.
Possible or not, it's gone. There was a thick-set guy in a black leather hat. I'm sure he jostled me.
Ah, that is most unusual in Japan. But it would be a mistake to call the conductor. We do not wish to draw attention to ourselves. I regret the incident, Bondo-san. I hope you will forget it.
Of course, it's nothing.
I shall make up for your loss by standing you a magnificent meal when we get to Kamigori.
That man in the buffet car, I'm sure I saw him again in the crowd as we got off the train.
Ah, what of him? Everyone has to get off at Kamigori. Forget about him. I have ordered the speciality of this place. Lobster.
Sounds great.
It is not the custom of this country to consume sake in a single gulp. But the grossness of your drinking habits will fit in very well with your future identity.
What am I supposed to be?
A coal miner from Fukuoka. There are many tall men in that profession. Your hands are not rough enough, but we will say that you pushed a truck underground. You are too stupid to yield a pick. You are deaf and dumb. You will carry this card with you always. Zumbo the Oshi. Deaf and dumb. Ah, and here is our lobster.
Looks delicious. But it's raw.
Of course. It will be a test of your dexterity with the chopsticks.
Good God, Tiger, the damn thing's alive.
I'll keep your voice down. Really, Bondo-san, you are a great disappointment to me. This is a very great Japanese delicacy. Eat it up without being squeamish.
Forgive me. Simply crossed my mind that honorable Japanese lobster might not like being eaten alive. Thank you for correcting the unworthy thought.
You will soon become accustomed to the Japanese way of life.
It's their way of death that's got me a little bit puzzled. Would you be so kind as to pass the seaweed?
We are going to take a look at the Central Mountaineering School. It is one of the secret training establishments of my service.
It doesn't sound very secret.
Oh, it is just a name. It's an old fortified castle where my agents are trained in one of the most dreaded arts in Japan. Ningutsu, the art of stealth or invisibility. You will see men walk across the surface of water, walk up walls and across ceilings, and many other tricks besides. I think you may learn something from this place.
I'm sure I shall.
I have never approved of agents carrying guns and other obvious weapons. My men are expected to be able to kill without them. All they may carry is a staff and a length of thin chain, which can easily be explained away if they are caught. You understand?
Tiger, we've been following this road for at least 10 minutes, and all that time there's been a motorcyclist on our tail. Have you noticed?
Oh, he is perhaps a speed cop. If he is anyone else, he has chosen a bad time and place. When we reach the castle, I will send a detachment of my men out in search of him. They will certainly track him down. These men are practicing an assault on the castle wall. It is nearly 200 feet high and offers few natural footholds.
They're scrabbling up it like black spiders. What's the significance of the black costume and the hoods over their faces?
Ah, they're wearing traditional ninja clothing. But in reality, the attack would take place at nighttime. They would be virtually invisible. Ah, in a few days' time, you will be doing something very much the same. Ah, the man on the end is the weakest of the team, huh? You can see how awkward he is.
Poor bugger.
Ah, it is of no account. The instructor would have failed him anyway. Now, let us go down into the courtyard. Once the men have scaled the wall, they will use bujutsu on the defenders, huh? Fighting with the stave.
Those sticks certainly carry a god almighty thwack. I wouldn't like to be on the receiving end. They look as if they're fighting for their lives.
They are. Observe carefully, Bondo-san. You may have to depend on Bojutsu for your life.
Ah, Anybody would think they were seeing their relatives off before crossing the Atlantic instead of a pleasure trip.
Ah, to the Japanese mind, one journey is much the same as another.
What's the object of this particular exercise, anyway? What am I supposed to be learning from all this?
I thought that a little excursion on the inland sea would cleanse our minds. But since you are clearly in a learning mood, we will go down to our cabin, drink a little sake, and I shall do what I can to correct your boorish ignorance of Japanese culture.
Okay, then. Ready for culture. Far away.
What do you know about Basho?
Nothing whatsoever. Sounds fascinating. What is it?
Oh, not an it of any sort. Basho was a great classical poet who lived in the 17th century. He perfected the form of the haiku. It is a verse of 17 syllables. For instance, in the bitter radish that bites into me, I feel the autumn wind. Does not that say anything to you?
Well...
Oh, this. In the fisherman's hut, mingle with dried shrimp, crickets are chirping.
I can't quite get the hang of that one.
Do you not catch the still-life quality of these verses? The flash of insight into nature? Now, do me a favor, Bondo-san. Make a haiku for me yourself. I'm sure you could get the hang of it. After all, you must have had some education.
Mostly in Latin and Greek. But give me time to think about it. And pour me another glass of sake. It might give me inspiration. This is the best I can do, Tiger.
Read it to me.
You only live twice. Once when you were born, and once when you look death in the face.
That is excellent, Bondo-san. Too many syllables, but a most honorable attempt. Most sincere. You were thinking, perhaps, of your mission.
Perhaps.
Is it weighing on your mind?
The practical difficulties are bound to do so. I've swallowed the moral principles involved. Things being as they are, I have to accept that the end justifies the means, even killing in cold blood.
Then you are not concerned for your own safety?
Not particularly. I've had worse jobs to do.
You do not appear to value your life as highly as most Westerners. Is there a reason for that?
Not that I can think of. But no more of your Japanese brainwashing. Pass me the sake, and tell me what happens next.
Tomorrow you are to leave the nest. But first, we shall drive out to Fukuoka to talk to the chief of police.
What kind of man is he?
Who?
Your chief of police at Fukuoka.
Conscientious, unimaginative, and he has absolutely no sense of humor, so don't try any of your silly jokes.
Tiger, I don't want you to think I'm paranoid, but that motorcyclist is back on our tail again. And I could swear we were being shadowed on the boat yesterday. Do me a favor and check him out.
Toga, we're being tailed. Let him pass us.
He could easily pull away from us on that bike.
Let's take a look at him. Give him a touch of the siren.
He's slowing down. Look out, Tiger, he's got a gun.
The man's got a gun. Get him!
Smart work. You train your men to jump out of moving cars. Pity he had to kill him.
He had no choice. Let's take a look at him.
That's the man who picked my pocket on the train.
And here is your wallet, Bondo-san.
Thanks. Everything seems to be still there.
And a notebook. All my movements for the past week and all the stopping places on our journey. You are simply described as a geijin. But he could have telephoned a description. This is a most unfortunate business. I apologize most deeply. I will naturally absolve you from your mission. It is entirely my fault for being so confident. But at least you have seen an example of the measures Dr. Shanahan takes for his protection. This is either a great madman or a great criminal.
Looks like it. I'm really quite keen to have a sight of the fellow, and don't worry about the mission. This was probably just the jolt I needed to get the wind under my tail.
Quite impressive, Superintendent. You build up a thoroughly comprehensive aerial photo of the whole promontory.
Even Dr. Shatterhand can't prevent us flying aircraft over his territory. That is the castle there. The most direct approach to it is on the landward side, as you can see. But it would be impossible to come that way unobserved.
And on the seaward side? How high are the cliffs?
About 200 feet.
And the whole line of the cliffs is encased in stone, making it part of the castle wall. What are those?
Gun ports.
And watchtowers at regular intervals. What's the drop down from the walls into the park?
About 10 feet.
And this five-storied affair is the castle, I take it. Looks like a stage set for Dracula. I might as well try to storm Windsor Castle single-handed. How am I supposed to get into the place?
Are you a good swimmer?
I can swim well enough.
And you could easily scale the cliff wall.
But how do I get to the base of it? Where do I start from?
There's an armor island only half a mile out to sea. It is called Kuro.
What's an armor island?
There are about 50 of them around the coast of Japan. The Ama are a tribe whose girls dive for a wabi shell. Clam. They are a great delicacy. The girls dive naked. Some of them are very beautiful. But they keep themselves very much to themselves, and visitors are discouraged.
It all sounds quite intriguing. But if they're that cagey about visitors...
The superintendent is distantly related to a family on Kuro, a most interesting family.
They have a daughter. Her name is Kissy Suzuki.
Kissy?
She was quite a celebrity. When she was 17, she was asked to go out to Hollywood. They wanted a Japanese diving girl of great beauty. She made the film, but she hated Hollywood. She could have made a fortune, but she chose to return to this obscure island. The press called her the Japanese Gabo.
Now she is 23, and everyone has forgotten about her. I have arranged for you to stay with the family. The Shinto priest who rules the island will see that you are accepted by the community.
Okay, so I swim out and scale the castle wall. Then what do I do?
You hide in the grounds and wait for an opportunity to kill the doctor. As I told you, he goes about in armor. A man in armor is very vulnerable. You only have to knock him off his feet. Then you can throttle him with the ninja chain you'll be wearing around your waist. If his wife is with him, you will throttle her too. She is certainly involved in this business, and anyway, she is too ugly to live. Then you will escape over the wall and swim back to Kuro.
It all sounds very simple. What about the poisonous plants and reptiles and such? I don't want to be blinded or go mad.
The ninja clothing will give you complete protection, and swimming goggles will protect your eyes.
My dear Tiger, you thought of everything. But I'd much rather have a little gun.
Oh, that would be crazy, Bondo-san. You know perfectly well that silence will be essential. No, my friend, use ninjutsu. It is the surest way of eliminating Dr. Shatterhand.
Have you got a photograph of this chap's face?
I think we have a copy of his passport photograph.
If I'm going to kill this man in cold blood, I should at least know what my victim looks like.
Here you are.
Thanks.
God Almighty. Blofeld.
Is something the matter?
Have you got one of the women?
Yes. Here it is.
Thanks.
What is it, Bondo-san? Do you know these people?
Lord, no. It's just that when I saw this man's face, it was as if someone had walked over my grave. If you don't mind, I'd like a little time to myself before we leave. I need to think this thing through.
Blofeld. It's a private matter now. Nothing to do with Magic 44 or Tanaka. It is a matter of Blofeld and me. He must have gone off his head. But there is a kind of logic in seeking refuge in a country which has an unquenchable thirst for the terrible and the bizarre and the cruel. And the whole infernal idea is on Blofeld's usual grand scale. The scale of Caligula or Nero or Hitler. Blofeld, the enemy of mankind. And what have I got to kill him with? Nothing but my bare hands and a chain of steel.
Bondo-san! Bondo-san! It is time for us to set out for the island. You seem preoccupied. Oh, think of all of those beautiful naked women you'll be swimming with. Eh? And this Japanese Gabo with whom you'll be passing the night.
I have spoken to the priest. There will be no difficulty. The village elders will be told that you are a famous Gaijin anthropologist who has come to study the Ama way of life. You are requested to behave in a sincere manner.
Which means you are not to go to bed with the girls.
Your name will be Taro Todoroki. Taro means first son, and Todoroki, thunder. The priest is not interested in your real name. And now, it is time to go down to the jetty. The boats will be coming in. Everyone goes to meet them and wrap the girls in hot blankets. It is quite a ritual.
They're beautiful. They're absolutely beautiful. And that tall girl, at least she's taller than the others.
That is Kissy Suzuki.
Suzuki-san no iga iidaro.
The priest says that the father and mother of Kissy Suzuki would be honored to receive you in their humble abode.
Suzuki-san no kawa wi ni natemaro.
The priest asks if you can row a boat. The father is stricken with rheumatism. It would be of great assistance to the family if you would deign to take his place.
And please tell his reverence that I would be pleased to row the family boat or to help in anything.
And now you must meet the family. Remember that you must not bow too low. They are only women.
My name is Kissy Suzuki. You don't have to bow to me, and I shall never bow to you. How do you do?
My name is Taro Todoroki. It's very kind of your family to accept me as a guest, but I don't want to be an imposition. Are you sure it's all right?
Whatever the priest says is all right. Say goodbye to your distinguished friends from Tokyo, and we can go home. I hope you're good at peeling potatoes.
I took a degree in it.
Bondo-san, I am certain that you will succeed, so I will not wish you luck, nor will I say sayonara. I will simply say a quiet banzai to you and give you this little present in case the gods frown upon your venture and through no fault of your own, things go wrong.
No, thank you, Tiger. You remember the haiku. You only live twice. If my second life comes up, I would rather look it in the face and not turn my back on it. See you in about a week.
Come on then, Todoroki-san, and give me one of those little bags to carry. For the sake of the villagers who will be watching inquisitively, we will wear the oriental-facing fabric.
Thank you. What time do we take out the boat?
About 5:30, when the sun comes up. Perhaps you will bring me luck.
Good morning, Kissy. A beautiful day for fishing.
You have slept well?
Like the dead. What's that extraordinary thing you're wearing?
This is ceremonial dress for diving, in the presence of important strangers. The priest instructed me to wear it in your company. As a mark of respect, of course.
I don't believe a word of it, Kissy. The truth of the matter is that you consider that your nakedness might arouse dishonorable thoughts in my impious Western mind. That is a most unworthy suspicion. However, I accept the delicacy of your respect of my susceptibilities. And now, let's get going. We'll beat the Awabi record today. How many should we aim at?
50 would be good. 100 would be wonderful. But above all, you must row well and not let me down. Not much further.
That's just as well.
We shall have the place to ourselves. The seaweed is thick on the rocks down there. And that is what the Avi feed on. It is deep, about 40 feet, but I can stay down for almost a minute, long enough to pick up two or three Avi, if I can find them. Now we are there. Stop rowing. The rope goes around my waist. Now keep it taut. And you feel me, Tag? Pull me up quickly.
Right.
Pass me the goggles. No!
She's like a fish. I hope I'll be able to put up some sort of show when it's my turn.
True. Great fat ones. There are lots of them down there. That is good. I shall rest now.
Shall I try?
No, we will have lunch first. There's a bowl in the box over there.
What is it?
Rice and seaweed. And you must give David a piece of fish.
Kissing, do you know anything about the castle on the headland?
We never talk of it. It is almost a forbidden subject on Kuro. It is as if hell had suddenly opened its mouth half a mile away across the sea. We believe the devil himself has come to live over there. The elders say that he is the incarnation of all the evil in the West.
Do they now?
And there is already a legion that has grown up on the island. It is that Ajizo Guardian will send a man from across the sea to slay this King of Death, as we call him.
Who are these guardians?
On the other side of the island, on the foreshore, there are five statues. They are rather frightening to see. They have rough bodies of stone and round stones for heads. They were put there centuries ago by our ancestors. They sit on a line of low tide, and as the tide comes up, it covers them completely, and they keep watch under the surface of the sea and protect us.
And this story of the man from across the sea, where did it come from?
Who knows? Now give me your watch. It is time for you to see for yourself what it is like diving for Arabi.
Oh, I feel as if I'd been beaten with a wooden truncheon. I ache everywhere it's possible to ache.
We caught 65 Arabi. That is very good.
Little thanks to me. Too much sake and too many cigarettes.
You caught 10. That is very good for a beginner.
Ah!
What's the matter?
A cramp. A cramp in my stomach.
Oh, quickly, take off your shorts.
What?
And lie face down on the ground.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to walk over your back. Lie still.
Ah!
Does that help? Are the cramps going?
Yes, I think so.
Good. When I have finished, I shall give you a hot bath.
Ooh.
And then you will have a very early night. Todoroki-san. Todoroki-san.
What is it? Is it time to go fishing already?
It is time, but there will be no fishing today. It is too stormy.
I must have slept for 10 hours.
There is something you should know. The priest came last night to say that the people came here yesterday on the boat from the mainland. They asked many questions.
What about?
They wanted to know about the visit of the men from Tokyo. They said they were guards from the castle, and it was their duty to prevent trespassers. They said that 3 men came out to Kuro, and only 2 returned.
And what were they told?
The priest told them that one of the visitors had been taken ill, and had perhaps lain down in a boat on the journey back.
A crafty old devil. Have the guards gone back?
The priest sent a boy up to the high place on the island, which looks down on the castle. The boat returned there.
I see.
Todoroki-san, I have a feeling of much friendship for you. I feel that there are secret things between the priest and you, and that they concern the castle. I think you should tell me enough to put me out of my unhappiness.
You are very beautiful and kind, Kissy. Lead me up to the high place from which I can see the castle, and I will tell you what I can. I was going to anyway, for I'm going to need your help.
What an evil place. I have never been here before. The people of the island have no wish to see what happens in the castle. They are frightened.
I don't blame them. The castle looks like something out of a nightmare. And the garden.
And what are those strange pits where the steam is rising?
Those must be the fumaroles.
What are they?
Holes where sulphur bubbles up out of the earth.
The smell is foul, even from here.
Kissy, tonight I have to swim out to that castle and climb the wall and get inside.
You are the man from across the sea who has come to destroy the dragon from the west.
Yes, Kissy, I am.
But why have you been chosen? Why should it not be a Japanese?
Because it is better that this man is killed by someone from the West. It would cause less trouble for the state if the whole matter is presented as being trouble between foreigners.
And after, will you come back and be my boatman again?
For a time. And then I must go back to England.
No, I believe that you will stay for a long time on Kuro.
Why do you believe that?
Because I prayed for it at the shrine. And I have never asked for such a big thing before. I'm sure it will be granted. I shall be swimming with you tonight.
No, Kissy. It's too dangerous.
You will need a company in the dark. And I know the currents. You will not get there without me. Now, it is time for us to see the guardians. The tide is running out, and they will want to inspect you.
They have no faces, which somehow makes them look more powerful. Why are they wearing white shirts?
We dress the stones every year at the beginning of the diving season, and we sing to them to make them happy and favorable towards us.
In my country, centuries ago, the Crusaders used to kneel down and ask God's blessing before setting out.
Then why don't you pray?
I can't do that. I can only ask for good fortune to accompany my enterprise.
Did you see that? All is well, Todorok-san. Did you see them nod their heads?
No, Kissy, I did not. This is close enough to the foot of the castle wall. I'm going to hide the flippers in this crack just above the high water mark. And now I must start my climb.
Would you be seen by the guards?
I don't imagine that the guards patrol the grounds at night. They need to give the suicides free entry. And now, you must leave me, Kissy. Look for me in a day or two.
I shall look for you every day, Todorok-san. Goodbye.
And now for the dragon's castle. It doesn't look much of a climb, and the cracks between the stone blocks should give me enough grip. A flight of steps leading down into the garden from the gunport. Come into the garden, Maud, for the black bat night hath flown. God knows what kind of bats Blofeld has in his garden. Vampires, probably. It smells sickly sweet. Smell of death. And the bubbling noise must be the fumaroles. Thank God there's a moon. What I need is a hideout. Somewhere I can use as a base camp. A snake. What are the snakes that really go for man? It's like playing Russian roulette, with all the chambers loaded. A lean-to shed. Just the job. And full of gardener's tools. Pull these sacks forward. It's quite a handy hiding place. It might give me shelter for an hour or two at least. But first I better take a turn round the estate. The castle, where the dragon sleeps in his lair. How the hell am I supposed to get into that? Walk up to the front door and ring the bell? But aren't castles supposed to have another way in? Or a way out, where his lordship could slip away quietly if things weren't going according to plan? Somewhere underneath the drawbridge. And the good doctor's castle is no exception. With only a chain and padlock to secure the door. What the hell's that? It's over by the lake. God almighty. His head's swollen up like a pumpkin, poisoned by one of Blofeld's pretty shrubs. He's making for the lake. God, no. Piranha fish. Hundreds of them. The doctor's banquet of death. Why don't the Japanese Air Force come and bomb this place into eternity? Set the whole place ablaze with napalm? Why do I have to do the job with my own bare hands? Don't you want to kill him? Don't you want to avenge Tracy? Snap out of it. Get back to the hut and wait until dawn. Blofeld's breakfast gong. And the guards are turning out. Going to comb through the bushes for the night's bag. They're certainly getting worked up about something. They've rooted out some poor wretch who's had second thoughts about killing himself. They're going to throw the poor devil in the lake.
What sort of music?
Only some poor peasant who did not want to die, my lord.
I hope you changed his mind. Carry on with your duties.
Blofeld, a knight in shining armor, like something out of a kabuki play. I could make a quick dash and pitch him into his own lake. I wonder if the piranhas could get through the chinks in his chainmail.
The fish make tidy housekeepers.
And the dumpy creature with the beekeeper's veil and rubber boots must be Irma Bunt, Blofeld's consort. The woman who helped him kill Tracy.
And the sea and the sharks see to the rest.
The sharks don't always complete the job. That spy we put through the question room was almost intact when they found his body down the coast.
Oh?
The lake would have been a better place for him. We don't want that policeman from Fukuoka coming here too often. Colonel tells me there are already mutterings in the papers about a public inquiry into our activities here.
And what shall we do then, lieber Ernst?
We shall obtain massive compensation and move on. The same pattern can be repeated in other countries. Everywhere there are people who want to kill themselves.
But the figures would be much smaller.
It is the concept that matters, lieber Erner. It is very difficult to invent something that is entirely new in the history of the world. And I have done that.
That is true. You have built a shrine to death forevermore. It is as if one of the great fairy tales come to life. A sort of Disneyland of death.
A what?
On an altogether grander, more poetic scale, of course.
One day I shall write the whole story down. And then perhaps the world will acknowledge the type of man who has been living amongst them. A man not only unhonored and unsung, but a man who they hunt down and wish to shoot like a dog. A man who has to use all his wiles just to stay alive.
He's mad. Stark staring mad.
If I had not covered my tracks so well, there'd be spies on every here even now to hand us over for official murder under their stupid laws. Want to kill us out of hand?
I'll kill you in your sleep if I have to.
That hut there. The door is open.
God Almighty.
I have told them in 1,000 times to keep such places locked. It is a perfect refuge for a spy or a fugitive. I will make sure.
Take care, Ernst.
Nothing is a match for a samurai sword. Nothing. But remind me to reprimand Kono, and to make sure a proper lock is fitted. Come, let us see what new delights await us.
No bones broken, but it was a near thing. That's the end of my hideout. So it will have to be tonight. Clock. The only sign of life in the castle seems to be on the third floor. So that's where I've got to make for. And that must be the warning helium balloon tethered to the balustrade with a streamer carrying the skull and crossbones. A warning to keep out, or an invitation to come in. Let's hope I can crack that padlock. Not much difficulty there, and no bolts on the other side. Won't you walk into my parlor, said the spider to the fly. I seem to be in some kind of cellar. Bats, but no other sign of life. And a great stone staircase going straight up into the castle. At 62 steps and a wide double door. I must be on the main floor by now. And the door looks pretty worn. No light on the other side. A quick twist with a jemmy and... And that room across the hall with the light shining through must be the dragon's lair. The Ride of the Valkyries. Thank you, Blofeld. Even if there's a nightingale floor between me and you, no one will hear with all that racket going on.
I think he's coming round.
What are those strange clothes he was wearing, Kono?
It is a ninja suit, Herr Doctor. These are people who practice the secret arts of ninjutsu. These people used to be much feared in Japan. This man has undoubtedly been sent to assassinate you, my lord. But for the trap in the passage, he might well have succeeded.
Du lieber Gott! It cannot be.
What is it, my dear?
The scar down the right cheek. The eyebrows have been shaved to give an oriental look. But I am sure it is him.
What do you mean?
This is the English agent, James Bond. The man whose wife you killed. I swear it. You have got to believe me.
I certainly see a resemblance, but how has he got here? How has he found me? Who sent him?
The Japanese Secret Service.
I cannot believe it. If that was so, they would have come with warrants to arrest me. We must proceed with great circumspection and extract the whole truth from this man.
Yeah.
First, we must find out if he is truly deaf and dumb. Kono, take this man to the question room.
Aye.
A disgusting stench of sulfur. A large clock with the quarters underlined in red. And a stone pedestal seat with a hole in it, which it seems I'm to sit on. No instruments of torture. And high up in the ceiling above me, an opening through which I can see the stars.
Commander Bond, or 007...
I made a dash for it. I might just get my hands round his throat.
You are now sitting directly above a geyser that throws mud at a heat of 1,000 degrees centigrade, a distance of approximately 100 feet into the air. Your body is now 50 feet above its source. The geyser erupts at exactly each 15th minute in each hour. You will therefore observe that you have exactly 4 minutes before the next eruption. If you are a deaf and dumb Japanese, as you maintain, you will not move from that chair, and at the 15th minute past 11, you will suffer a most dreadful death by the incineration of your lower body. You prefer not to give up the play acting? Very well. On the off chance that your papers may perhaps be partially correct, my guard will now repeat what I have said in Japanese.
Not a very attractive proposition on the face of it. There's a small wooden box by the side of my throne. It must be the regulating valve for the geyser. It might come in useful somewhere. But not now. 11:14. Time to move, unless you want a flush of volcanic mud up your backside, James.
Very sensible, Commander Bond.
Well, Blofeld, you mad bastard. Your effects man certainly knows his stuff.
You are quite right, my dear Irma.
Yeah, yeah.
I shall pay more attention to your judgment in future. Kono, go down and search the gardens. He might have brought accomplices.
Aye.
All that remains, Mr. Bond, is for you to talk, and then you will receive an honorable and quick death by the sword. Have no misgivings. I am an expert with it, and it is razor sharp.
Blofeld, you were never stupid. Many people in London and Tokyo know of my presence here tonight. Retribution will certainly follow if I do not return.
All right, Mr. Bond. But I am so sure of my facts that I am going to kill you here and now. My fine sword has not yet been blooded. Yours will be an admirable head to cut its teeth on. You agree, mein Liebchen?
Of course. What you decide is always correct, but be careful. This animal is dangerous.
You forget, mein Liebchen, since last January he has ceased to be an animal. By a simple stroke of surgery on the woman he loved, I reduced him to human dimensions. Let me show you.
I suppose you know you're both as mad as hatters.
So is Frederick the Great, so is Nietzsche. We are in good, illustrious company. On the other
one
hand,
of the guards has left his wooden
Bond?
Stave over by the wall. If I could only get to it, I could put up some kind of fight. But the woman standing close to it, so she'll have to go first.
My genius.
Ernst!
You fool! You'll only suffer a lingering death. I shall hack you to pieces.
I wouldn't be so sure, Blofeld.
I'll slice you limb from limb. Your little stick won't help you. I'll cut it into matchwood.
It's time you lost your little toy, Blofeld.
What kind of man are you without a sword? I don't need a sword, Blofeld. I'm going to kill you with my bare hands. Now, Blofeld, die. Die. Damn you. Die.
There was something else I had to do. What was it? The geyser. Close off the valve, and in a few minutes the geyser will blow the whole place to smithereens. Pity about Irma, but she'll have to go up with it. That should do it. 2 minutes to go. But how the hell am I going to get away? The helium balloon on the terrace. Untether it and hold onto the rope. It's my only chance. You only live twice. Once when you were born, and once when you look death in the face.
As readers of the Times will have learned from earlier reports, a senior officer of the Ministry of Defense, Commander James Bond, CMG, RNVR, is missing, believed killed, while on an official mission to Japan. It grieves me to report that hopes of his survival must now be abandoned. It therefore falls to my lot to give some account of this officer and of his outstanding service to his country. James Bond was born of a Scottish father, Andrew Bond of Glencoe, and a Swiss mother, Monique Delacroix, from the canton de Vaud. His father being a father...
Can't you remember anything? You do not remember who you are or where you come from?
Nothing. Nothing. Except a man's face. I think he was dead. I think he was a bad man. What is your name?
My name is Kissy Suzuki, and you are my lover. We live on this island and go fishing together. You have a terrible wound on the side of your head. You must have fallen while you were climbing the cliffs after seagulls' eggs.
The nature of Commander Bond's duties with the Ministry, which were, incidentally, recognized by the appointment of the CMG in 1954, must remain secret. But his colleagues at the Ministry...
I love him, Kanoi-san. He remembers nothing of the past.
Nothing at all of his former life.
I told him he came here from another island years ago. I wish to keep him and care for him and marry him.
That will not be possible, my daughter. In due course, he will recover and go off across the world to where he came from. And there will be official inquiries about him from Fukuoka. And even from Tokyo.
But you could instruct the elders to say nothing. If the day comes when he wishes to leave, I will not hinder him. But in the meantime, should Nakura honor the hero who was brought to us by the gods?
James Bond was briefly married in 1962 to Teresa, only daughter of Marc-Ange Draco of Marseille. The marriage ended in tragic circumstances.
He is fully restored to health. But I cannot get him to respond to me. However much I press myself against him or caress him with my hands, he remains indifferent.
Ah, that is why you come to Happy Shop.
Yes. Has his wound made him impotent, do you think?
It's just possible. He may have forgotten how to perform act of love. You have money?
How much?
5,000 yen.
Yes, if you really think...
This phial contains liquid from sweat glands of 4 toads. And this is powder of dried lizard. A combination of 2 mixed into your lover's food should prove infallible.
Thank you.
However, to make doubly sure, and for extra 1,000 yen, I provide you with excellent pillow book.
What is a pillow book?
See for yourself.
Very well. I'll take it.
That was a fantastic meal, Kissy. What do you call it?
Sukiyaki. You always liked it.
What's this book? How on earth did you come by this?
It is what we call a pillow book. Lovers use them. And the picture's strange.
Kissy, take off your clothes and lie down. We'll start at page one. Vladivostok.
What did you say?
Vladivostok. I found the name on one of the pieces of paper in the privy. It has some kind of message for me. I connect it with a very big country. I believe that country is called Russia. Am I right?
Yes, Taro-san. That is so.
I have a feeling that I have much to do with this Russia, that a lot of my past was concerned with it. I must go to this place, Vladivostok, and perhaps it will awaken memories of my life before I came here. Will you help me, Kissy?
Yes, I will help you, Taro-san. But you must take care, for the Russians are not friendly people.
Surely they would not harm a fisherman from Kuro. Soon, I must go there. But let us go down to the boat and find David. It is a wonderful day for fishing. Vladivostok.
That was You Only Live Twice by Ian Fleming, dramatized for radio by Michael Bakewell. The part of James Bond was played by Michael Jayston and Tanaka by Clive Merrison. Henderson, James Lawrenson, M, David King, Kissy, Sayo Inaba, Ando, Bert Kwok, Irma, Maxine Audley, Blofeld, Ronald Herdman, Maloney, Michael Turner, Trembling Leaf, Danielle Allen, Tracy, Emma Gregory, Mariko, Tara Dominic, and Kono, Mark Straker. Other parts were played by the Radio Drama Company. Technical presentation by Tim Sturgeon, Anne Bunting, and Alison Carter. The play was directed by Michael Bakewell.
Next Saturday, at the same time, here on 7 Drama.
BBC 4 did a series of Ian Fleming's James Bond series over the course of several decades. Well, that's it for this week's podcast of Airchecks. There will be more for next week. Airchecks is a podcast that is uploaded every Saturday and broadcasted on the KTI radio network every Sunday at noon. See you on the same time and same channel.